It complements the flavor perfectly. And it's so weird because it's nothing like any other cuisine. It really isn't. I can't even tell you another cuisine that tastes like that. But it's so good. And what I like about Mediterranean food is usually when you get it, you get such a good variety of stuff. Like I got something that came with hummus and pitas. You dip the pitas in the hummus and that was delicious.
Robust.
Insanely flavorful chicken. It's not dry. It's freaking
robust.
Give me this dipping sauce.
But it's garlic infused dipping sauce.
Robust.
I will tell you guys is thus.
Robust. Robust.
It came with their rice, which is the seasoned rice that just tastes, again, it tastes kind of different from other cultural rices. It has peas and carrots, but it's also got this unique seasoning in it that's really good. And then also a side salad, which was like lettuce, tomato, onion.
Robust.
Insanely flavorful chicken. It's not dry. It's freaking
robust.
Give me this dipping sauce.
But it's garlic infused dipping sauce.
Robust.
I will tell you guys is thus.
Robust. Robust. Robust.
We went and got dinner. Now, this was a double-edged sword. I actually admitted this last year. I'll say it again. I actually do play some mobile games. I do. All right? The ones that I play are free to play or incredibly inexpensive. Like, you spend a dollar here or there to make progress.
This one's for all my baby girls.
Got me that gotcha.
I love it.
Got me that gotcha. Gotcha. Begging for fucking tips and shit on Street Fights. WWE Champions.
I'm
stupid. WWE game plays like Candy Crush. Moving gems around, breaking colored gems.
I love it.
Again, it's pay to win. The more money you sink into it, the more characters you can summon, the higher chance you'll get the better characters, etc., etc.
All right.
Got me that gotcha.
I love it.
Got me that gotcha. Begging for fucking tips and shit on Street. Gotcha.
Gotcha.
Got me that gotcha. Thanks for the money, dummies. Supercuff. That was a mobile game I played like 5-6 years ago. A lot. For about a year, I played it pretty hardcore. All right. Even at that point, that was before everything kind of fell apart with YouTube and everything. I was putting a little bit of money into it. I was playing for the top cards. I was playing the shit out of that game. Okay. After about a year, they launched what they called Season 2, which reset all the cards in the game and made all your progress essentially worthless. And I said, this game fucking sucks. What a complete waste of time that this was. All right.
Now, what does the sugar do in the sauce?
Adds sweetness, adds a contrast. If you don't, it's all going to be tartness, and you won't have any kind of sweetness.
It's going
to
be acidity from tomatoes.
Right. You'll have
and then
spice. Tart and it's acid and nothing else. All right. So now we got to stir all that in, and then we add our final ingredients, and then the meat.
This one's for all my baby girls.
Italian wife. Italian wife.
It complements the flavor perfectly. And it's so weird because it's nothing like any other cuisine. It really isn't. I can't even tell you another cuisine that tastes like that. But it's so good. And what I like about Mediterranean food is usually when you get it, you get such a good variety of stuff. Like I got something that came with hummus and pitas. You dip the pitas in the hummus and that was delicious.
Robust.
Insanely flavorful chicken. It's not dry. It's freaking
robust.
Give me this dipping sauce.
But it's garlic infused dipping sauce.
Robust.
I will tell you guys is thus.
Robust. Robust.
It came with their rice, which is the seasoned rice that just tastes, again, it tastes kind of different from other cultural rices. It has peas and carrots, but it's also got this unique seasoning in it that's really good. And then also a side salad, which was like lettuce, tomato, onion.
Robust.
Insanely flavorful chicken. It's not dry. It's freaking
robust.
Give me this dipping sauce.
But it's garlic infused dipping sauce.
Robust.
I will tell you guys is thus.
Robust. 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 Robust.
got dinner. Now, this is a double-edged sword. I actually admitted this. Ludwig the Detractor. Did 100% you're asking me about food co-op with Rings of Redemption. Guys, I mean, what would we do co-op in? What are you talking about? Fuck you!
Kevin.
That was my depression.
Blame it on.
Taxes.
Have a heart attack.
Blame it on.
Trap, 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 trap.
Blame it on.
The Detractor.
You guys are blaming me for fucking e-begging. Blaming me for e-begging. Every day, all day, 1,000 people ask me about my weight.
Bling.
I get stressed out.
That was my depression.
Bling. Bling.
That was my depression.
Bling.
I may be living. I may be begging. Begging for fuck. Tips and shit.
Fucking Tevin and his shithead fan base.
Sean Rankin.
Taxes.
Liquid Richard
and his shithead fan base.
You guys are blaming me for fucking e-begging. Blaming me for
e-begging.
Every day, all day, 1,000 people ask me about my weight.
Blame you.
I just stressed out.
That was my depression.
Blame.
That was my depression.
Blame
you. Either subscribe, donate, or get the fuck out. Fuck
down, no.
I may live in a damn world.
Ladies and gentlemen,
hello. Welcome to damn world.
Get that ass band.
That was my depression.
Bling.
That was my depression.
Fuck out.
Blame it on the game. Blame it on the lag.
Fucking Tevin and his beautiful fan base.
Sean Rankin.
Taxes.
Liquid Richard.
And his beautiful fan base. Fucking Kevin and his beautiful fan base.
What's up, everyone? We are here. That Being Said podcast. I am ALT Insider, as always, brought to you by the power of many legends around me that support me. And I've got two of them with me right now. Hopefully we get another one here. Steve of the Dead is apparently not with us yet, but hopefully he's going to join us a little bit later. Meerkat out this week as well. But the legends I have brought will power us through, I promise you. First, before we get to our guest-style legend, let's get to our regular-style legend. He goes by the name of Fantastic Mr. Sam. How you feeling today, my friend?
Yeah, good, as always. As always, looking forward to this.
Sweet. And second, last, but definitely not least, a legend of the highest order. He goes by the name of Ludwig World Order. How you feeling, my friend?
Happy to be on. I'm a big fan of the show. Also a big fan of all the guests that you've had on so far. So it's a hunter's dream come true, for real, to be here.
Awesome. And yeah, obviously, me and Sam obviously know your work for many years now. So many great videos. But some people out there might not have heard of you. So can you please tell us a little bit about your backstory here before we get into the madness of the week? I want to hear a little bit about Ludwig here.
The how you became a detractor story?
Yes.
One of my favorite questions that you guys ask, because there are so many different detractors from all walks of life, and they all pretty much all have the same sort of conclusion when it comes to DSP. It's
like, yeah.
The guy's got issues. He's not happy with what he's doing, and where is his money going is another question I think a lot of people come up with.
Definitely.
But So back in the day, okay, I was a unironic fan, shameful enough, of that guy with the glasses.
Nothing wrong with that. Me too.
Yeah, and that back then it was a real different time. Like back then, Netflix was something that came in the mail, right? It was something that showed up in your mailbox in like a red envelope, and you pulled out a disc. Like it was so wild. Like subscription-based like cable services were sort of dying, and it was like in between that moment between it got taken over by like online streaming services. So you really felt like at that point there could be like a group of people who could rise up sort of the ranks from like the YouTube world into sort of like the more mainstream sort of Hollywood setting. And you do see some of that, like Smiling Friends, for example, is one of those like mainstream Cartoon Network shows that was really built from the grassroots, from like YouTubers.
Yep.
And at that point, you could really think that that guy with the glasses had that same sort of trajectory. And if they were really going to break that sort of surface, they were going to need, you know, like a lot of help, a lot of people who could do like special effects and really take over a lot of the slack of their production.
Yep.
And I really saw them that way, you know, regardless of like how funny they were or how talented they were or really like what they had going for them. It did feel like they were at least rising up as opposed to going down. And then by the time To Boldly Flee came out, was really just like the jump the shark moment. Where you just sort of realize, like, yeah, these guys aren't really going to break that surface.
Yep.
And out of all of them, I felt like Spoonie was sort of the most talented character actor out of all of them.
Yes.
And just putting that aside just for later. And so, like, years later, you know, I stopped watching that guy with the glasses altogether. Because after The Bold Leafly, it's like, this is, you don't want to hitch your ride to, like, a sinking ship, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, with the school, focused on life, ups and downs, and years later, I'm like, you know, like, what happened to those guys? Like, where are they now? The question that a lot of people ask. And I looked it up, and that led me to a little website called The Kiwi Farms. And each one of them had a thread on them that got me all cut up. Long story short, they're all just absolutely insane at this point. Maybe like out of 20 people, maybe two of them, like outside of the fringes, are semi-normal. The rest of them just like absolutely out of their minds, including Spoonie, who already wasn't like at the best of mental health, even at that point early on.
Yeah.
That was around the time that Mr. Mediker put out his series of that guy with the glasses people. And that's the video that he made on Spoonie. And in that video, he mentions the king of content. And I was curious, like, who is this guy, this king of content? And I looked it up, and it was this guy, Darkside Phil. And it jogged my memory because I remembered, like, years ago, I heard a story on the news about this guy who jacked off on a live stream. So it was literally like, oh, it's the guy. It's that guy. Like, at the time, yeah. I thought, you know, all right, like, you know, it's embarrassing. But I'm sure that guy, like, went off the internet at some point after that.
Yep.
But no, it turns out he kept going. And it's pretty ridiculous.
real quick though, because I want to get your story for sure, but that's an interesting thing, because all those guy with the glass people, some people might not know, we're talking about the guy with the glasses channel, one of the first, in that beginning time period, people that made videos about usually movies, internet, pop culture crap, but there's so many of them that turned out not normal, right? So maybe, is it more probable if you were like a big YouTuber or video maker back then to become not normal in modern times? Because think about it, so many of them are, you know, bordering on lolcow or officially lolcow, right? That's a, you know what I'm saying? Well,
I think one of the reasons that made me realize that To Boldly Flee was really the end of it is that was the moment when you really realized that this wasn't really an actual group of friends who were really like, who were really indebted to each other. It was mostly just a group of people who were being paid by exposure. And that's something that the Change the Channel documentary really opened a lot of people's eyes about, is that everyone assumed that these people were being well financially compensated when they really weren't. It was like a Project 7 situation. If you look at, there's a reason like all the people on Project 7, they're wearing t-shirts that advertise their own thing, their own like YouTube channel, because that was basically what it was about. DSP was a really big acolyte of Doug Walker, and he built Project 7 along the same lines as those sort of anniversary movies, where he would bring all these people together and he would pay them, quote unquote, in exposure. And he wouldn't really pay them financially. He would be like, well, you would get attention for your thing and you would draw more people into your audience, and you would make your money that way, not from the show itself.
Yeah.
And how that works is it's like a stock, right? It goes up in value. It goes up and down. So if you're being paid in exposure, your value is based upon the value of the guy who's giving you that exposure. So if that guy with the glasses goes down, so do you.
Yeah.
And so that's what I think that Change the Channel documentary, or that document, was all about. It was them really expressing their resentment on the fact that exposure that they were being paid with didn't pay out in dividends.
Yeah. So that's a good point.
That's partly why they went all like nuts, because like it was an entire waste of their life. They were being exploited to the very end.
Yeah, true.
I think it's possible that just the same thing happened as with Phil as well, is that, you know, they probably dealt with it in slightly different ways. Maybe not. Maybe it's more similar than you think, but maybe they had that early success with YouTube, didn't know what to do with it. And then when, you know, the situations with YouTube, you know, the apocalypse and all that stuff hit them, it hit everyone, you know, in the same way, and not everyone knows how to adapt, I guess. This is just me kind of spitballing, I guess.
I actually don't really blame Doug Walker. I mean, that was just the way it was, and he cut ties with them when they were ticking time bombs. Like, honestly, they were going to blow up eventually. So,
yeah.
Kind of don't blame him for cutting ties with them and really starting the road down a more like sanitized, more corporatized sort of Disney sort of content that he's going with now. If you're getting caught up with Doug Walker lately, it's a lot different than the content he used to do. It's a lot more like advertiser focused.
Yep. It's just, for me, it's not interesting at all. Like, but you know, back then it was.
Yeah, that's kind of the direction you have to go in if you want to be mainstream, which is something that DSP is, as we all know, just fighting and bucking against. He wants to have fun down at level one, which is it's kind of giving himself too much credit, because that makes you think he's like a year one level one streamer, which I don't know if any year one streamer who's out there and being like, all right, guys, I want to play this video game, but I can't afford the video game. You guys are going to have to come in and buy it for me. It's like, no streamer is like needing their audience to buy them their video games. Like, that's level zero. That's why I call it like the sewer level podcast. Like, he's not at level one.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the thing as well. Like, he even went on a rant recently about how, like, he couldn't understand why new Twitch streamers were popping up and why they were, you know, being enthusiastic and all the rest of it. And I'm like, it's because they want to do this. You know, they're passionate about doing this. They're not, you know, this isn't what it is for you. For them, it's completely different. You know, they want to play games, they want to talk to people, and they want to make something worthwhile. You know, they're hungry, and that's the difference. And he just doesn't see it that way.
Whenever anyone asks him, like, what's your advice for a streamer, basically his answer amounts to just don't put in any effort. Don't do any effort, because it might fail, so don't even bother. Just like, what great advice.
Sewer level podcast, we got to pick that up. We got to carry that sewer level podcast going on.
He actually tried to make that a thing back in the day. He's like, oh, whenever there was a sewer level in a video game, he's like, oh, hashtag sewer level, and he tried to get it trending. So I had an idea, like, let's get it trending. Let's pick up where he left off and rename his podcast the sewer level podcast, because it is definitely below level one.
Well, it's my argument is, it's not even a podcast. It's an extension of his plugs for everything. And now he tells one story. He makes sure he has one thing to talk about, and that however long that is decides how long Q&A is. Right. So schedule, Q&A. I think that's pretty much the layout.
Everyone in the chat, I mean, they're always like, can you just get to the video game? And DSP would always say, well, this is the segment that I have, because if I did play a video game and like people were asking me all these questions, it would get in the way of the video game. And so now when people are like, hey, can you play a video game? He's like, well, I'm doing my podcast right now, and the podcast is this set length. And it's basically just replacing the excuse.
Yeah. The best part was, remember in Overwatch, he got into a lobby after all that waiting during the podcast. Like, I'm in the podcast. What are you guys, crazy?
Yeah.
Like, I play video games like every Thursday. I get right into the game like after the intro. I like have the game up and open when the stream begins, and I get right into it. It's like, why would you want to just blue ball your audience like that when you're telling them you're going to play a game? But it's all about, he knows that, like, it's the only thing I tune into is the pre-stream. It is the dumbest podcast on the internet. It's funnier than Netflix, like, for real. I don't give a shit about the gameplay. Like, I tune out after he's like, okay, wrap it up, and he goes into the gameplay. And
he knows that. That's why,
right, that's why he wants to keep it around.
Yeah, Catspur has a good point. You gave me that thought, Catspur. Thanks for that comment, because you're right. He got tired of people saying the pre-stream sucks, it goes too long. But if he'd rebrand it, it's a podcast now, then you could just stall for those tips and wait for the tips to come. Yeah, yeah. You know, this is a podcast. And yes, I do have a podcast. Let's not forget that.
Just so you guys know, I'm not irrelevant, okay? I downloaded OBS. I mean, it's a free program, and I hit start streaming, okay?
Uh-huh. Yeah,
I'm not irrelevant.
Okay, so that was an awesome look into how you got started, kind of some other topics got in there.
Well, sweet. I didn't really like Fenix because when I got into it, just I found out that the DSP community, the tractor community, not necessarily the DSP community, like I see it as like there's a village, right? And there's like a swamp in the middle of it, like a swamp and swamp creatures. And there's a wall around it. And then outside of that swamp, there's like a bustling village. And like the village is great and people are great in it, but they have that swamp right there in the center. DSP sees it as kind of like the opposite, right? Like he's the village in the middle and around him is the swamp and all the swamp creatures. But like the DSP community is so great because they really only have just like one rule, which is don't be like DSP, which is actually a pretty good rule to live by, it turns out. The SOK had an issue with like him making money as a content creator, but that's kind of like, if DSP wants to separate like the old guard and the new guard, it's like the SOK and then just like everyone else who came after it, who don't really have those sorts of qualms in regards to like personal conflict or like doxing and things like that. Like
yeah,
we don't really have
thing. Yeah, that weird.
Yeah, we don't really have
SOK,
anything
yeah.
embarrassing about us that other detractors can hold over our heads. So there isn't really that sort of intimidation factor, and it's a lot more open and it's a lot more free. I became a detractor around the same time as LSB did, and I stole the idea of the VTuber model from him. That's what the original like Ludwig model came from, and then I stole the anime girl avatar idea from Ann Lee. But it is a lot of fun. Like again, I have a background in multimedia. So I do like video editing, basically anything that goes into a movie I can do a little bit of. So 3D modeling is something that I took to like a fish to water, and I have like this giant Wheel of Fortune spin wheel for all the costumes I go through. I got like 90 costumes at this point.
Awesome.
And it's just part of like, I haven't been streaming for very long. It's like maybe a year. My big debut was the Mass Effect Legendary Edition, that restream. If you remember that one, the premiere had like a $3,000 tips goal or something.
Yes.
And the last stream of that, he got $7. the $7 Shepherd finale, which is legendary. I'll never forget that. Like it was so wild restreaming that. And his Shepherd was dead just on the ground as he was ranting. And for so long that I was able to get out an entire song on my soundboard before he started the game up again. And remember, that was a race. Like I was racing to the end of Mass Effect on my own playthrough. And he skipped Mass Effect 2, which I don't know why you would buy that collection and then not play the three games together as like one cohesive narrative. Like, why would you skip the middle one? And he jumped from like 1 to 3. And I had to cram in like a playthrough of 2 in the middle of it to stay caught up. And it was just like night and day in terms of like gameplay. I think his audience was kind of upset that everyone started dying around him in the game, because if you don't do any sort of like these loyalty missions, the squad dynamic kind of falls apart. I think they were really disappointed by that. But back into like, it's just plays into more just like the tractor community is so gigantic when you compare it to like other locales. There's like multiple Discords and things like that.
It really is. We can talk about why we think that is, right? I think it's because Phil had you can say stuff about Phil with no guilt because of how he does do so much deplorable stuff.
Yeah, nothing
bad
happens to you.
You know, because
nothing
so
bad
deplorable.
Happens to you if you insult DSP.
Like, I think like Wings on some level. Wings is like, there's a lot of stupid stuff and he's very stupid, but in the end he's just a flawed human, right? But like Phil is like alien level, right? Like he just thinks about the world in a totally wrong way, so entitled, begs like crazy. Like there's so many things that like, dude, you just gotta, there's so many bad things about you, how can we not say this stuff? So that's what I think makes it so big, is because it's such a wide net of people that catches so many people into his wide net of stupidity and craziness, right? That's what I think. But
yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like it, as I think Steve always says, you know, there's always a million different people, and they've all got something different to say about him. Like there's so many facets to his personality that you can pick apart. You know, it looks, again, Steve says, you know, Brittany Gates can talk about finances and business, and
Steve Adet's psychology stuff is like really really good because he has that background. That no one really has.
We should get him on the show sometime.
Yeah, so he should make long videos. His videos are too short.
Hope he goes to long form content someday. But he goes, please go ahead, Ludwig. Keep continuing.
What really got me hooked was Snort Brunel specifically, and like the whole "This is how you don't play" is just the idea, just like this form of comedy where you could just take somebody's words and just splice them together, and that's really all you have to do to make someone laugh. Yeah. Like that's like a sort of dissident sort of. Like it's a form of comedy that I really never encountered up to that point. And it gave me just that sort of sense of wonderment that like classic old That Guy with the Glasses had. Uh-huh. And so I just wanted to see if I could really replicate that and to see my take on it. And so I hadn't played Bloodborne up until that point. DSP had announced that he was going to be doing a redemption run. I remember our buddy Ludwig being kind of a big problem for him. So I named my channel after him.
Oh, cool. Okay.
And then I made the This Is How You Don't Play. It has, last time I checked, over like 100,000 views on it.
Yep.
Ended up being watched by the owner of Kiwi Farms. He said it was his favorite one out of all of them, which it went full circle. You know, I checked out Kiwi Farms and here I ended up a big fan, big patron, support a lot of the Tractor Twitch channels. Again, I've been streaming for like hardcore, maybe like a little over a year now. 9 to 5 every day except for Friday. Awesome. And I feel like I have advanced kind of past level one. I don't know what level you would say, but
definitely past level one. Yeah.
I set out what I wanted to do, which was to really prove to myself that streaming isn't as arduous as he makes it out to be. No. Sure, it can be pricey and expensive, but if you put a little bit of effort into it, you can create things that just persist. And just are easily accessible and you can reach to like without any sort of effort. And you just have to do it once, really. And he just doesn't want to do that. Ever since he got that laptop donated to him, he could be using that Stream Deck he has. He could just plug that right into the laptop and use that, but he doesn't want to learn it.
Because
he doesn't understand it. He thinks it's like a meme generator. He said that like literally out loud. He said it's like a meme generator, like what it's like. We're back in Sega CD games with like Marky Mark make my video. It's like it's like a keyboard basically. It's like a button mapper where you map things to the buttons. It doesn't take over the stream for you.
Button mapping's already out. He's like, what's this? You didn't tell me. What is this? You didn't tell me. God. You know, it's like it's over. And that's funny too. He said that. He said that before he did this meme shit he's doing now, because now he's kind of doing that kind of meme shit, right? Like the border of the stream, you know, the sounds. Like he's doing stuff that would be good with a Stream Deck now when he wasn't before.
It would be so annoying if he got that working. He would be mashing it so much. I hope he never figures that out.
I know. He needs to look to the right.
As annoying as that little sound box is, if he got that Stream Deck working, it would be like 10 times worse.
Oh, yeah. He imagine the memes he'd be playing? The most used memes on the internet, he'd be pushing them like crazy. That laughing dude from Spider-Man. God. Like, that's like one of the first ones ever. Like, just spam the shit out of that. You know?
That jump scare he keeps doing at the end of his pre-stream at the moment. Yeah.
Like, happy Halloween. And I'm just like, dude, it's not Halloween, though. Like, you can't. Yeah. There's no Halloween month. Like, this is a guy who celebrates his birth week,
Halloween month, bitches.
Christmas month. Like, Christmas is going to be unbearable. He loves Christmas because he wants to be the Santa Claus that begs the kids to give him their toys. Like, that's his favorite thing.
He does love holidays.
Fans are the only kind of people who are like, hey, Phil, it's my birthday. Here, have some money. And it's like, bro, this is for you. This is your day. What are you doing?
Crazy.
I'm going to give him my money.
Let me quick shout out Barry Linden. Thanks so much for your super chat, my friend. Phil needs to be placed in a loony bin. I think so. A lot of people would agree with you on that one. But Ludwig, please continue if you have any more for your origin story. I'm loving this so far.
Well, I mean, it just feels like a really positive community to be a part of. I've been learning a lot. This year, I dedicated myself to music. I got like 3 tracks out. Not exactly an entire album, but hey, you reach for the stars, right? Sometimes you might crash into the moon.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
Maybe next year I'll focus a lot more on animation. It's just like it's a process, you know. It's been a lot of fun. Like I said, more entertaining than Netflix, man. It's just it's so stupid. It's so funny. It's fascinating just how just far down every single day he goes. Just you think he can't sink any lower, but he somehow manages to pull it off.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I love it. I love it. I love the community, all of it, you know.
Yep.
And played some Phasmophobia last night with the community. Just a blast.
Awesome.
Awesome. I mean, the first thing I saw from you was the Shorty's music video. The Shorty rock to the beat with your boy.
That's someone else's song, but yeah.
I know, but I thought that's how I found you. The first video I ever saw of you, I was like, all right, instant subscribe. And like, then I found all the rest. And one of my other favorite videos I want to make sure people know about is that Mr. X in Resident Evil when you did the
Mr. Tax.
X gonna get it to you. The audio on that man is so awesome, dude. That was awesome. I was like, this guy's because you can tell you put the work in, and that's the only thing I like is like. It doesn't matter if you have the best, editing quality, which you do. Say, like, it doesn't matter to me all that stuff. But if you show you're putting in the work that you want to make it unique and cool, that's what I like. And right when I saw that, I was like, man, this guy, I know that probably took you like so many hours to get that audio right on that video. I'm guessing. You can tell me, though. It didn't?
Actually, not. That was a very quick turnaround.
That was awesome.
That whole Mr. X meme was big for the Resident Evil 2 remake. And I'm like, hey, this could work for like DSP. Uh-huh. If you want to like see massive editing, look at like the This Is How You Don't Play Bloodborne, The Old Hunters, or like the Guardian 8 video for Sekiro.
Yeah,
like that was one of those things where it's like it's done when it's done. Like I had no set schedule. It was just like I wanted to do this thing. Like the end of it with Wings of Redemption, Low Tier God, and Richard Vutek. That wasn't originally my idea. My idea was just to have like potatoes, just have no onions. That was it. That was the meme at the time because PewDiePie was like making DSP the Onion Man. I just wanted to make them all onions, and then Alfred actually recommended that I make them all other lolcows. Like Wings and LTG, and so that's how that finale ended up, and that's what people say is like their favorite part of the video is the living failures, where it was so epic because at the end, like there's a meteor shower, and it's just like a double KO; they just all die at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Yep. All right. Well, that's a great look into Ludwig's history here in the community, and obviously, there's a big future coming up. It's like he's going to be there for a while. I hope. But it is our job to talk about the week that was in DSP nonsense. So I think personally, I'm going to go to, we did cover this on our recap stream, which happened in the middle of the week, a rare recap stream. The tweet, the ill-fated tweet that Phil laid out.
Oh yeah.
I'll read it too, just in case. I know everyone here knows it, but that's what, so we have the conversation there. I'm going to read it one more time. And this is after Phil self-proclaimed scoured the internet to find something to innocently quote, before I go to sleep. This is what he came up with after scouring the internet for something to innocently quote tweet. He said, I spent the vast majority of my free time from age 13 to 27 playing competitive Street Fighter. I always thought I'd end up with something like this. And it's a picture of the guy's gaming room with some cabs in there. Now at 40, I have zero desire for it. I see countless people who never play competitively have these. Go figure, lol. So...
when he says like I wasn't trying to be insulting, like I believe him, like he's just so bad, like his best is that bad. I'm pretty sure what his mindset behind this was too, because this is fresh off the Street Fighter 6 beta. He was complaining the entire time. He hated it. He complained about input lag, dropped inputs, basically everything he complains about all the time. Enemies were overusing a spam exploit tactic that he couldn't figure his way out. He talked all about like, oh, I don't know any of these sort of flashy tactics that they've introduced in Street Fighter 5 and 6, but what I can bring to the game are fundamentals. And if you watch this gameplay, especially near the end with his guile, like, and if you try doing like a play-by-play, like calling every move he did, I was trying that on my stream. And literally, like, if you're calling out his move, it's just like, jump in, throw, low kick, jump in, throw, low kick, throw, jump in, low kick. And those he didn't, like, capitalize on any of the connects that he did and turn them into any combos. And it's like, you're not even doing fundamentals. There's a reason why Chris G was like, this guy doesn't even play like he plays Street Fighter.
Yeah,
and of course,
that's the worst part, yeah.
Yeah, he intentionally misinterpreted that and pretended like he was saying you don't play Street Fighter 6, and it's like, no, you don't play any Street Fighter, like, and his fundamentals are so bad. And so that was the gameplay. And then afterwards he's like, okay, what am I gonna do? I'm gonna scour Twitter, right? I'm gonna find Alex Valle's tweet, and whatever the fuck he says, I'm gonna agree with it. I'm gonna say, yes, whatever you're saying, I'm gonna agree with you. And then he's gonna find Justin Wong's tweet, and he's gonna be like, whatever the fuck he says, I'm just gonna agree with it. Because he's projecting. He thinks that everyone else needs the same sort of validation that he needs. And if he agrees with their tweets, then he somehow believes they'll be like, oh my God, is that
on the horizon. Do you see it? It is Philip. Philip Darkside Burnell, he has returned to us, the prodigal son. He has left us in the dark days of Street Fighter V, and he's returned to grace us with his magnificence in Street Fighter VI. And DSP is sitting back, you know, with his gin and his phone open, and he's fantasizing about all of this, and a minute passes, and nothing happens, no response. Two minutes passes, nothing happens, no response. And he's starting to be like, oh no, I don't think this is working out. And so he goes back on Twitter and he's scouring and he finds pictures of arcade cabinets. And he's like, oh, man, I'm never going to have anything like this. But you know what? That's okay. I don't need that shit anymore. I'm a grown up. And then he tweeted that out just basically as much of a dickhead as he is. And like he just went a step too far. And that's what happened. He just got slapped back.
And he picked the wrong motherfucker. He picked the wrong dude to do that to with his, you know, someone that's finished higher than him at Evo, by the way, which is worth mentioning.
I don't know anything about him. Like, that's some sort of defense. Like,
I know. I don't know anything about the dude. And of course, like you said, your story is probably very true, very close to the truth there, because he was so quick. Oh, Valle's tweet. Yeah, let me say something. Oh,
and it's so contradictory. If you watch the footage, like, he didn't like it. He thought it was a bot.
No, botch. Yeah. Remember, he thought it was bad. And the community kind of liking this. So I guess I got to say that too.
So I just got to elbow my way in.
Yeah. It's just so bad.
It blew up in his face, and the game isn't even out yet.
I know.
That's the crazy part about it.
I had the exact same thought as you, Ludwig, about him kind of fantasizing about this, you know, being this sort of past FGC member that's returned. Right. And I like to think that he, in his mind, he's imagining like a, you know, an award show or something, or a Hall of Legends. And it's, you know, the return of Darkside Phil, you know, oh, remember that guy, you know, oh yeah, I remember him, you know, like, you know, like he thinks he's this like forgotten but like well-remembered guy. And
yeah,
and
like you see him as like a bumbling oaf, like a well-meaning but just stumbling guy who just he accidentally left his camera on one day and that was the end of him. But that was like the beginning of the end. Like, ever since getting kicked off of Blip, he's had this just obsession with gaslighting anyone who just doesn't like him.
Yep.
Like, I need to make like something really clear, because you guys don't go on for very long. It's only like an hour long show, but I need to get this out of the way.
Go ahead.
Whenever he claims companies get rid of him after like mass false flag reports from trolls, he's lying about that. He does this to claim he's a victim of cancel culture when he's not. Like, for example, say like if Nick Fuentes gets put onto a no-fly list because he's threatening an airline stewardess, that's not cancel culture, right?
Yeah.
And that's what happened, by the way. He claims he was put on a no-fly list because of his political opinions. That would be cancel culture, but that's not what happened, right? He threatened a stewardess. That's why they put him on a no-fly list. And so that's the same mentality. DSP is trying to claim that people are engaging in cancel culture. Like, my tweet that got him banned off of Stream Elements, that was after Music Mouse 7 sent Stream Elements that clip of like from Left 4 Dead 1 from years ago.
Yeah.
And I can understand Stream Elements looking at that clip and being like, nah, this isn't really an issue. Like, in context, it was a joke and it was a long time ago. But his reaction to that when he called out the tweet specifically and specifically was like Music Mouse 7, like the guy's name. I'm looking at that and I'm like, this is an actual problem. Like, if someone sent this clip to Stream Elements, they would definitely take notice of that.
Yeah.
And you know, the next day I wasn't streaming and I was curious. I was like, I wonder if someone sent this clip to them. And I tweeted it out to them. And that same day, like, I'm not streaming. No, I'm hanging out. I'm playing a Cult of the Lamb and I check in on Ant Lead stream. And DSP's not playing a video game. He's like directly addressing his audience. And I read the chat and they're all talking about Stream Elements and I'm like, oh shit. Like, I didn't think anything would come of my tweet.
Yeah.
But apparently, like, they looked at it, they saw that like he was intimidating the guy, gaslighting him. And that's something that these support systems can't really abide.
Yep.
The branches of these companies can't have people going around trying to intimidate and gaslight people just because they got reported to their customer support service.
Yeah.
DSP even directly references my tweet claiming that I don't know the definition of gaslighting. So I went ahead and I quickly put out that video, basically like a gaslighting montage. And
He always claims these are examples of cancel culture when these companies come to these decisions independently, regardless of what's in the complaints. He's claimed this happened with Blip, with AdSense, with Teespring, with Streamlabs, with Machinima, with Twitch, and now with Stream Elements. You'd think DSP would realize who's the common denominator in all of this, but he'd rather stick to his narrative that he never does anything wrong.
Yeah. And if there's anything, if it was, right? If it was one little stupid comment he said, that would be it. You know, Stream Elements, all these companies would be like, all right, whatever, we don't care. One little thing. But there's so many, you know, it takes 2 seconds to see the history and all the, all the responses to you. To your tweet were just like another example, another one, and another one, and another one. It's just endless, you know.
Everyone needs to delete their Twitter, but especially him, after that cabinet tweet. Like, if Twitter is making you that butt blasted to where like you're talking about it days and days later, obviously this is not a healthy thing for you to have.
That's what I said on the Wednesday show. If DSP loses Twitter, it'll be a net gain for his brand.
There's this gunt-headed moron who calls himself Ethan Ralph, who actually believed DSP when he claims that he was banned over mass false flag reports, because he's a dumbass. And this is why DSP,
dude, yeah, the guy that got, I remember that dude somewhat. He's the guy that got beat up in a different country one time.
Something about
kid.
Not
yeah,
eating
whatever.
Poop or something. But this is why DSP keeps hammering this lie over and over again, because like he says, there are people out there who are stupid. There's people who are gullible, but they really should know better and to realize that this is a pattern with DSP. A lot of the people tipping him were like, "Oh, we got to fight against cancel culture." But like, I'm a very big proponent of free expression. I'm against cancel culture. I want people to be punished for their behavior, not for their opinions.
Yeah.
Like DSP being you know, punished for his opinions. I'm not really a big fan of that, but when he goes after people who are specifically trying to bring attention to their customer service and he gets slapped down for that, I don't really feel any sort of guilt for doing that. Mm-hmm. And I don't think people should really have any qualms about holding them basically to the same terms of service standards that everyone else has to abide by.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think really the problem was when he gets to the attacking of certain, you know, especially with tax people with mental health stuff, he's just attacks, right? It's not like a joke or anything either. He's like, listen to you.
Yeah, I don't know if you've been watching him recently, but I think after getting banned off of Stream Elements, he's kind of backed off of that. He's tried to avoid calling people mentally ill now, and he's fallen back on just like, oh, you're stupid, you're an idiot, you're dumb, which is basically all he has left if he can't gaslight someone. Call him like poopy. Shitty poopy caca.
We got a nice comment for you, Ludwig. Want to make sure you hear it here. Dominic coming in hot here saying you are a legend in the detractor community. Thanks so much, Dominic. You are also a legend in the detractor community. And thanks so much. Oh, question for you here from Disnude. Go ahead. I got to ask you. Do you have a favorite song by Elsa from Frozen? Mine is Let It Go. He's doing his Derek impression, by the way.
I used to work at a helicopter factory. And oh my God, they always played Elsa's Let It Go on it. And it made me dance. I was just swaying back and forth. And people would call me Sway. And it was really annoying.
About the tweet, before you set it up, because we got a lot of stuff to get to this week for sure. This week. I do want to say that Phil, my favorite quote that Phil said was when he's like, what did you insult me for? For clout? Enjoy it. So my question to you, everybody, is what was Phil doing his initial tweet for, if not for clout, if not for Twitter clout, right? That's not saying it's a fit. He was just trying to get people to be like, yeah, Phil, cool. That's kind of the same thing, right? I mean, what is the guy's writing back to you? Of course, he wants some Twitter likes. He might, I don't even know if he cared to give a shit about that, but he wanted some people to, you know, okay, funny tweet, dude, cool. What was Phil looking for if not the same fucking thing? You know what I mean?
Exactly. He's even basically asked for people to reply to his comments before as well, hasn't he? Like he said, you know, like, oh, I'll get all these impressions, but you know, I get a million impressions for every tweet or something exaggerated like that. But you know, no one ever replies to me saying, yeah, good job, Phil. And it's like, well, there's your answer, right?
If you're scouring, you're going too far. Let's stop scouring. If you quit scouring, you won't get yourself in any trouble. You know what I'm saying? Go ahead, Lee.
Yeah, if you're scrolling Facebook and you start getting ads, it's time to close Facebook.
yeah, you know, like just give it up.
But it's a wonder who he's even tweeting to, because like it's kind of like what I said is like he wants the built inroads with these people, but when that doesn't work out, he just gets mad and frustrated, and he's like, well, I don't, that entire cabinet thing was just sour grapes in a nutshell. He's like, I can't afford this, my house isn't big enough to have this, so therefore I don't want it anymore. And he's pissed off that people are annoyed by it. Yeah. And it's got to be so frustrating. For, like, by the way, we all fell for his trap, by the way. He's like, I want you to tweet me, but I'm not going to read it. It's like, imagine living with someone like that who's like, I want you to explain this to me, but I'm not going to listen to any of your explanations. And it's like, oh, well, fuck. Like, I don't know anything. And then if you try and explain it to him, like four words in, he's like, I don't care anymore.
It's yep.
Like, God, yep. Like,
I do want to kind of, Barrett Welf's a good point here. Consequences for actions rather than opinions. And that's what, yeah, Ludwig and we all agree with, right? You should have pay for your actions, not for just having an opinion, because anyone can have an opinion and they're all usually fine. But
I tweeted a follow-up, like, I don't know if you've heard about this, the PayPal fining people for like medical misinformation. That to me, I think, is very untenable. Like, if that happens to the DSP, you would have to really look at the landscape and wonder, like, who else is going to be victimized by this sort of thing. So reporting him for that, I don't really see that as sort of like an attack against DSP. I think that's sort of like overwhelming the PayPal report system. Okay. So people who do that, I don't really see them as even engaging in cancel culture either, because it's attacking the system more than it is really attacking DSP. And so just throwing that out there.
I heard PayPal said that was all nonsense. Maybe they changed their idea.
Reporting, I guess.
Yeah, they might have changed their idea, though, after they found it out. But I do want to kind of let's transition from that tweet to more FGC stuff, which when Phil decides to describe to all of us, explain to all of us, what an OG is.
No, yeah. Oh my God. It's so condescending.
So like, awesome.
I say this on my stream a lot. He's got like an 80-point IQ and he thinks that everyone else is like 30 points below that. He doesn't realize just how insulting it is to be that condescending. He's like, OG, if you don't know what that means, it's original gangster. But then eventually it evolved to mean original gamer.
Oh, it's like what no one on earth ever said that ever. Original gamer.
And he's like trying to disassociate himself and be like, well, I'm not talking about me, I'm talking about like the OGs in the Street Fighter community. But then you hear him talk even more and you're like, obviously you're trying to like lump yourself in with this group, because you got slammed by sort of the zoomers of the community. So like every old man, you're like, the kids don't know what they're talking about, they're against all the old people just because they're old and for no logical reason.
Yep.
God, could you be even more of a boomer?
Yeah, it's just, and then he was talking about, that's what it was in his Street Fighter 6 review, and he's like, he's all the nonsense. Then he said, like, I was surprised to learn about fighting amongst the OGs, and then he has to, of course, explain what OGs are. So he goes new gamers aren't respecting, another quote here, new gamers aren't respecting the old ways.
Yeah, I like how he's like, I brought money into the community. It's like, what, like as an open wallet, losing money matches and having to pay out because you talked shit and got hit. Said, I brought money into it. What a way to put it.
What's the new, I just want to know what the old ways are exactly. So like, everyone playing in person, you gotta, it's just like the old, it's just things change, And he's like, and someone said like, OG should change their name to boomers. And Phil, of course, is like, oh, wow, this is so disrespectful. Not to me.
So pejorative.
It's not me. I'm not an OG, but just real boomers negative. And he said, and also he said, I've been outside the community for so long, I don't know what's going on. He again, always says, I don't know what's going on, but then he knows everything. Right.
Yeah.
So I don't know what's going on in the community, but I know everything. I'm going to tell you about it for the next hour. Let's go.
Yeah. Like, that's what he does. This is how you don't plays are filled with like just the most disgusting, awful comments. Also, he doesn't watch any This Is How You Don't Plays.
He hasn't seen
any of them, but he knows that they're filled with disgusting, horrible comments from the comment section. And that's why he had to turn it off, as if we can't get similar comments from his stream chat.
And like, also, I'm going to stick by this point. He has stopped saying style guys. He has just stopped.
Really?
It doesn't happen anymore.
He got bullied. So he can get bullied into anything.
I think it's definitely because someone told him in his little crew in his private Discord, hey, they're making fun of you for style, so you might want to chill out. And also slow. He's kind of stopped saying slow as much either. I'm getting a little nervous here. But he said, and then the end of that OG crap, he said like, I want nothing to do with that toxic community, is what he said.
But we just then what were the tweets for?
Like, exactly. Why are you tweeting Valle? Why are you tweeting Justin Wong? What is that? If not chasing clout,
they're not
trying
friends.
To get back in the community. Yeah, that's all it is.
That's what I like about Jaha when you had him on. He's like, I can actually call these people up and have a conversation with them. You can't. Like,
yeah, because Jaha's not an asshole, and they were through that community together. They're part of the community together, but everyone. Everyone, no one likes DSP in the community, right? So many people, that's what they said.
Because, yeah, that's like the community that he says, like, finally, this is where I belong. This is where I can be a part of, like, something big. He made one friend who disavowed him. Like, that's it.
Yeah, yeah. And that's got to be the toughest point. Like, let's get real. That's why he's really hurt by this, you know, this tweet, I think. That's why it really burned him, because, wow, this is something I'm supposed to know about. I'm supposed to be a part of this community. People know me for this. And then they just don't have nothing to do with them. And it's hard to discredit a whole community, right? He's trying to a little bit. Like, he discredits, like, detractors easily, like they're all crazy. That don't listen to them because they're all this. But a whole community, it's tough to envelop into one discrediting thing. And he's trying to do it with this, they're toxic, but it's not that easy, like as he would like it to be, right? To just say, like, to discredit everything someone's saying, you know what I mean?
It's got to be easier than discrediting John Rambo, because that reaction video, like, they literally just sat there and they were like, Phil, this is why we're mad at you. This is why we don't like you. This is the problems that we have with you. And it all just flew right over his head. Like, so if he can do that, then I don't see why it's so difficult for him to do that for the FGC. That's why, like, I feel so frustrated and irritated by people who try and go into his chat and try and give him advice and try and tell him how to improve his stream. It's like, don't you realize this is a guy who betrayed his own mother? Like, his own mom tried to do this and he betrayed his own mom. What makes you think that you can reach him to a level that his own mother couldn't? And it's like, save your money. Like, you can't do it.
No,
I don't want, like, anyone in his chat, really. He deserves to be in his chat alone. Like, anyone in there giving him attention is just giving him exactly what he wants.
Well, then I should ask you, what about this, his current chat? Because you've been here, you've been in the community for a while. You know, his chat has now evolved to, I don't know the percentages, but it's about, I would say, at minimum, 50% of people are there just to pretend to be a fan, but say stuff that'll get a rise out of him.
It's mentally exhausting to read, actually. Like, in the best sense of the word, it's just mentally exhausting. It's like North Korea, because you're not allowed to say anything. Everyone lies about everything all of the time. Because if you say anything that goes against the line, you not only do you get bullied by DSP, you get bullied by the other people in his chat. Uh-huh. And something, if you do any research about North Korea, I'm sure a lot of you have, North Koreans are really good at sarcasm. They've developed, like, as sort of a survival tactic, a way to insult their society in a sort of way that doesn't get them in trouble. So you see that a lot in DSP's chat, those same sort of, like, mental backflips where, like, a lot of backhanded compliments. Every compliment is, like, so over the top. It's unbelievable by anyone else who doesn't have DSP's ego. Like, oh my God, you're, like, the best Street Fighter player ever. Everyone else reads that and you're like, obviously this guy's full of shit. But DSP reads that and he's like, oh, well, like, I'm not that good. I'm pretty good, you know. And it's like, it's so ridiculous. They're just blowing smoke up his ass. They're basically just, they're throwing tinder on the dumpster fire. They're just keeping the fire going, whether it's through their verbal support or through their money. And it's just, it's hard to watch. Like, I hate Snow Carl. I know, like, I'm in the anti Snow Carl camp. I know there's pro Snow Carl people out there, but Snow Carl strikes to me as, like, the Code Castile of troll tippers. I don't know if you guys knew about Code Castile.
No,
this is some old lore, but he would stream snipe DSP in Call of Duty, in, like, the open world Call of Duties, like the Warzone and stuff like that. So he'd stream snipe him, but he would die. He would lose to DSP in one-on-one firefights. So you're like, what the fuck are you doing, this man? Like, if you're going to, like, go into the match and just lose, then why are you here? And that's how I see Snow Carl. It's like, DSP just makes an example of him, goes on for way too long, and it's basically all summarized in, I'm not the problem, you're the problem. He treats Snow Carl as sort of the ambassador to the detractor community, and Snow Carl is more than happy to act like he's taking words out of our mouth.
Yeah, he's earned a little bit of, like, this is the most loosely, I'm using this word as loosely as possible, fame for his, you know, his antics, right? I mean, I think that's what he gets out of it. I don't get what some of these people do, that, like, the Nathan Wongs and a few of those other people in there.
Oh, yeah, the Baxters.
That are just, like, saying
the Chocobocos.
I feel like, what do you get out of that? I don't understand it, but there's some people like Phil for his gameplay and they donate money for that. Like, there's a few of those around, but, like, what do you get out of just being in chat, being a member, and just saying stuff to Phil to make him happy. I really don't get what they get out of it. I guess they're thinking they're pulling one over on him. You know what I mean? Like, I don't
know. Or it's like some sense of community. Like, there's been a real problem lately since ever since he banned like a lot of people. He banned like Black Lady Walking. He banned a lot of these regular like sneak dissers. And a lot of other people are very, very unhappy about that, which just shows you it's not really about DSP. It's about their own little network of what they have going. And if DSP like steps over the line and disrupts that, then they get really mad and they threaten to pull their support.
Yeah. So the chat is an interesting place right now. I mean, not interesting. It's interesting exhausting. At all. But
like it's hard enough to listen to DSP as it is. But if you listen to him and you try to follow along chat, like you have just no energy to do anything else because it's just so just mesmerizing in the worst way.
So bear a good point. So DSP wants to say one thing, do another thing, and then never ask him about what he actually did. Just remember what he said, because that's the most important thing, right?
He'll be like, the best example of that is the Halo multiplayer stuff. Him promising to play Halo multiplayer, and then when people are like, "Hey, why aren't you doing this thing that you promised?" He's like, "Oh, people are begging me, screaming me to play Halo multiplayer." Or like when he's like, "There's no new games coming out," and people are telling him about like Cult of the Lamb or Xenogears Chronicles 3 or like fighting games like Guilty Gear or Melty Blood, he just ignores them. And then later he's like, "Oh, people are demanding, yelling at me to play Cult of the Lamb, play Xenogears." And I'm just sitting there and I'm like, "No, I don't have to." And it's like, what the fuck? Like, what a misinterpretation of what people are trying to tell you. They're trying to help you and you're taking their comments and you're using it to slam them back.
Yeah. Like your most active and let's say not active, but your most supportive fans give you a suggestion and you just shit on them. If it's not in line with what you already want to do, that's what he does, you know? So if it's not what he's already thinking about doing, then you're an asshole. That's a bad excuse. But he'll wait a few years, and then he'll say, like, 3 years later, like, "Oh, my God, millions of people asked me to play, Mega Man 4. I'm finally playing it. No support. What the hell?" Like, all those people that wanted to see it 4 years ago, they dipped out.
Right. It blows me away when people recommend a game, and DSP is like, "No one's recommending that game." It's like, what about the person who brought it up?
Yeah,
like immediately just discounting their existence.
That one, yeah, exactly.
And it happens all the time.
Oh yeah, it does it so many ways too. Like $10 tip, it'd be like, "Oh well, now we're $20 away from the goal. No thanks. Still, top tip is OSE, thanks," or whatever, you know, Jack's Raxer. Like just shitting on any tipper that gets them close to the goal, but doesn't get the goal. Those tips are forgotten about fast. You know, like it's like he just moves on to the next goal, you know?
God, like, it was so bizarre. He's like he had to confront the idea that they're priming the tip jar and bringing him close to the goal, and then he can be like, "Oh, we're so close to the goal, guys." And he brought that up in terms of like his sandwich and salad stuff. And that had a tip jar, and he was like, "Yeah, sometimes they would put like dollar bills in there to show like, yeah, the tip jar isn't empty. People like to give us tips." And then once he realized what he was saying, he was like, "Oh, but that's stupid. That's a really dumb thing for people to do." And it's like, "What?
Exactly.
That's what you did at work." And you say that all the time. You're like, "Oh, we're so close to the goal." So you're saying that like that's a stupid mentality?
Yeah. Like no, that's what he said. I thought he said, like, "If you fall for that, you're stupid." Right. But he wrote the exact playbook of what you do with the tip jar mentality. And then he's like, "Hold on. Well, I can't say that anymore. So yeah, but if you believe that, you're stupid." So, okay.
Yeah, you put that a really, really good way. I'm a really big fan of like really short, succinct takes, especially since listening to DSP. He talks a lot and says absolutely nothing.
Oh,
so I'm a big fan when people are like say a lot in a very short amount of words. By the way, I'd be remiss in bringing this up. If you're not a member of the That Being Said podcast and you haven't checked out Alt Insider getting his wife Chu's take on just comparing Kat to Panda Lee. If you listen to her initial take on that, I swear to God, your sides will just detach from your body and fly off into orbit. Like,
I won't spoil it. That's a good one. She summed it up in the one sentence. It was incredible.
Oh, it's so great. And you put it well too. It's like DSP has this sort of framework for what he's going to say before a pre-stream, and he sticks to that framework no matter what.
Yep.
Like there is no veering off of that path. It doesn't matter like what the chat is doing. He doesn't take a read of the room just at all. And it goes very well with another thing that DSP that Theo said about DSP.
Yeah.
Theo said that he just said shit, which is a very short statement, but it says so much. Like he just says shit. He just says what he thinks sounds good in the moment, and he doesn't really take into account like anything else, like how it contradicts anything he said before, or yep. how he's gonna have to like deal with that in the future. He just says it like at, in the moment. And like that's fine for a lot of people, but he records himself and uploads the video to YouTube.
Yep.
So it's like check here.
Stays forever, and he forgets what you sometimes I really think he has to review, you know, like, all right, hold on, what did I say about this? Okay, I gotta get that right. Okay. I wonder if he does that. You know, I'm sure he doesn't because that's actually work. I guess that's why he contradicts himself so much. But like you really have to keep track of what you say, but he doesn't, of course. You know, it's like, I never said that. What? Oh God, more distraction. Let's get this guy out of here.
I forgot. You know? I don't even remember.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
like, how convenient.
It's important, but it's his words are important. But if you remember them too long, then you're crazy. Remember that comes out too, right? I said that like 5 years ago. Come on, okay.
Hey DSP, tell us about a sandwich you ate in 2014. Oh well, I'll tell you all about it. And I'm like, oh really? So you do have a memory.
Yeah, that's true. When he wants to talk about it, oh, he definitely remembers it. Oh yeah, if it's food related, what's your favorite? DSP tries it. I don't know. Hang on a minute. Stop stream. Pause. Hold on. Everything, you know, it's like the most important shit in the world because he wants to talk about it, right?
Okay, the food discussion is so unbearable because it's like it's such a primal, just like caveman sort of discussion. Everyone eats food, and so it's like always something that someone can talk about, either that or the weather. But that only works if like you're living in the same general area. Somehow DSP doesn't understand that, and he thinks people living in Africa want to hear about the weather in Renton, Washington. For a fucking half hour. It's like, dude, this isn't even interesting to the people who live in your area. They would just look out into the sky and see it for themselves. Why do you think people want to hear about your weather?
Well, it's 78 degrees Fahrenheit. It's burning up in pure sun. Well,
he's begging to pay the mortgage on a house that can't even keep him from sweating in mid-October. Like,
well, no. Remember, this is one point we cannot forget is this all brought on by himself. He had a fine air conditioning system in place. You're the one who chose to take it down. Now you suffer the consequences. You know what I'm saying? That's what we need to say.
The consequences.
Yeah. Very good. So,
yeah. But he's, you know, of course he said like everyone agreed it was going to be fall weather. Like, okay.
Yeah. The fucking weather people fucked up, man. They got the weather wrong. What are they doing? What are they thinking?
Full sun. That's my favorite thing.
I like that theory from Poe's Mystery. Pure like he's sun. Looking at his phone and he's seeing the full sun icon, and that's what he means when he says full sun. He says he sees the icon that isn't behind the cloud, and he's like, oh, that's a full sun.
Unfiltered sun.
This is why DSP is the top. The lol cow, if you want to put it that way, because on a lesser week that would be a whole 2-hour podcast just on the weather. If you know if we had to, we could do that and it would probably be great, but there's so much more to talk about that we can't
I know.
You guys need a longer show. That's why you need Steve the Dead on, so we can make like a 24-hour podcast.
We're done moving from the weather, but he is and what he said today or yesterday, my brain swelling or something.
Oh God. Like I actually, before this, I went on Google and I'm like, what is a headache? Like what actually causes your head to ache? Is it like your blood vessels are literally like increasing in size? Is that really what's going on? Or are there other factors involved? And it's like, like the conclusion I came up with is that no one calls headaches brain swelling. No one calls it that.
He said he couldn't sleep because of brain swelling. Yeah.
And then, that's why people are like, dude, if you're actually suffering brain swelling, and God, I wish Steve of the Dead were here because he would know like the medical technical term for why that's how you don't want to describe a headache. Like that's something you need an emergency ER doctor to come crack your skull open if you're talking about like actual brain swelling. It's just a headache.
You go to the doctor if you think your head is swelling. I think my brain's swelling, I'm going to the doctor. You know what I'm saying? I know how DSP talks about healthcare is so shit in America. And I agree, but I still got to go if my brain is swelling.
Then he had like a weird like seizure, and like he covered himself up with blankets because he thought that the reason he was shivering so much is because he was cold, and then he woke up sweaty. Like dude, maybe you do need to see a doctor about this.
Well, that's some point. Me and Sam were talking about that before the show. Let's bring it up now. Is Sam, you can introduce it. We were talking about it before, about the health issues, right?
Yeah, well, it's all sort of guesswork at this point, but it's, you know, people are starting to connect the dots a little bit, you know, just with the breadcrumbs that he's laying at the moment. But there's a lot of dropping sort of references to almost like mortality and stuff like that, you know, how he's constantly on about, oh, I'm not going to be here forever, and you know, I'm getting older and all this stuff. And then there's the doctor's visit, you know, there's always an appointment which, you know, could mean that he's going to the doctor every week, you know, or, you know, there's all this stuff that, and people are starting to put together now this conspiracy theory board or whatever you want to call it of all this stuff. And it just seems,
like,
you know,
you mean like what the appointment is for?
Yeah, like he's talking about an appointment, like it could be, is it a weekly thing he has to go to? Is that why he started this exercise? Jogging.
I don't know. I think it's more cat related. I think she has, she needs to get her wisdom teeth pulled out. And they're really putting that off. So in order to just keep her from getting sick, they're having to get antibiotics. Basically, just it's such a terrible situation. We could talk like all about Kat, because I mean, I made it. This is how you don't play of Kat, and she is a very interesting character.
I watched that.
Yeah, she thought Aloy was a robot in Horizon Zero Dawn. That's just like the tip of the iceberg.
And she does. She's plays very much like Phil. Like she doesn't care about the mechanics.
Yeah, even worse.
No reading's happening.
Yeah,
at all,
well, she doesn't have like an audience there to hold her hand, so it's hard to say if she's even like measurably worse. But they're both terrible. And it's wild.
Yeah.
Like, they're not normal gamers.
Before we change something on the health, we should talk about the knuckles, the red knuckles. We all see that, guys.
No.
Oh, okay. I'll put it in the chat here, and Poma's Future posted on his Twitter, and. I have the picture. Sam, could you put it up, I guess? I guess it's...
I've got it here, so yeah, I can do that.
Okay,
just give me, like, 2 seconds.
So
this was the first I'd seen of it, to be honest. I didn't know anything about this until just before we went on. So I don't really have much to add, but I can show you the picture. Bear with me.
I see some people asking for you, or this is how you don't play, so I want to put that in.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah,
Kat Horizon Zero Dawn. That was pretty wild. She couldn't beat the last boss, and she ended up doing basically what DSP did with Persona 3 and just linked to a YouTube video. Like, here's the final boss, because she rage quit the ending of it. It's her obvious comment. She's like an unironic fan of DSP. Like, she has the same mannerisms, the same
sort
of reactions to things.
Definitely. Very much the same, like, oh, okay, there's a big tree over there. Cool, okay. And, you know, like, just telling you what's on the screen, you know? Like, oh, okay, there's an animal. Whoa, this guy's big. I guess I can't do that. Oh, this hammer doesn't work here. It's like, so really, wild. It's really interesting. It's worthwhile. You don't have to watch the whole fucking 5 hours. If you want to, that's all totally cool. But at least watch.
I cut out 24 hours out of that. It was, man.
Wow.
Because her combat style, literally, she would kite an enemy, run away, wait for it to break pursuit, and walk back to its starting area, and then just do that over and over again. Like, that's the way she fought enemies. And she had to, too, because she never upgraded her weapons. Like, she had the starter green weapons and never went to the merchant and bought new ones.
Yep. So, yeah, Sam, put that as Steve's avatar, the Knuckles, please.
Okay. That's a good idea. It's kind of over his screen, but yeah, that's better. That's a better idea.
But yeah, so that's the Knuckles that happened when he came back from break. And before the break, they were normal, officially confirmed by Poem's Mystery. So we're all about doctors here. Sam's a dentist, though, but he doesn't know about skin issues, I don't think. It's definitely something, right? I mean, that's looks weird. A lot of people wondering, is he maybe the water's hot, that kind of stuff. But any thoughts, boys? I'm not a medical person. I don't know what's going on here, but it's scary.
It reminds me of what Jaha was mentioning, is that DSP was like literally yelling at his dishwasher, being like, "You're not going to interrupt my day off. You're not going to get in my way." And like, not even like an inner monologue. He was literally like yelling this, and then Kat had to come downstairs and be like, "What the fuck are you doing, Phil?" And it's like, Jesus, like, I wouldn't be surprised if he's like literally just hitting things. Like,
I wonder, but look at that thumb. Look at the thumb, right? So, yeah, I see you guys saying it might seem punch, right? But look at the thumb. That's not a place that gets hit. Look at the thumb crease. There's some redding there, too, right? You don't punch there, right? It's kind of.
So, you're thinking like bad circulation.
Something like that, right? Some people are saying gout and stuff. I just don't know much about gout. I thought that's only on your foot.
Yeah, it settles down to your feet because of gravity.
That's what I thought. Yeah. So, I mean, anyways, it seems like there's a health thing going on there. Obviously, we're pretty stupid if we keep wondering that much about it, but it's something, right? It's something happening there. So next thing to talk about, I think, if we could, sorry, Sam, for making you go through all the work of the picture just to cut it off, but
on the fly research.
Yeah, very hot water, right? That's what it looks like to me, maybe very hot water. But does he wash his hands? You really think he washes his hands?
I don't know. I can't see that being hot water. That's too, I don't know. It's in too kind of, I feel like that it's in too kind of like localized places to be hot water. I don't know. I feel like your whole hand would be red if that was the case.
And yes, I don't know if you guys are aware of Jack Scalfani, but he's had like three strokes and one of his hands is just like shiny. It's like a shiny, like Halloween model hand. If there was a better shot, you might be able to see some of that.
Some people saying you got a bad pull, so he punches the wall. Okay.
Yeah. Like, speaking of Jack Scalfani, his son is a big fan of punching walls. And like you see photos of him in his house and there's like holes punching the wall. It's like, dude.
All right. So to move on to our next topic here, I do want to talk about the day before the day off this week was one of Phil's slowest days ever. First stream was, you know, 30, whatever. And Disney Dreamlight Valley was one of the most, you know, thickly mixed bags ever. So thick. Could cut through it with a knife. You can't cut through it with a knife because it's so thick, the bags. He broke out all the stops. We're talking eyes hurting. We're talking Game Pass payment went through. And you guys know how much a Game Pass is, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. He's like, I'm in the negative for this stream. And then he gets like a $70 tip that's like, here, this will cover your Game Pass. And he's like, oh, well, hooray, the begging worked.
Yep, yep. And it's all because that's when he was supposed to record his Patreon videos, right? But he said, oh, he didn't have enough money the week.
I could be recording Patreon. I don't even have to be here, you guys. I could be doing something else.
That was some low, low stuff.
He does that every time he runs to Twitter. He's basically like, well, my YouTube audience isn't providing, so I'm going to run to Twitter and see what they have to say. It's like, so you're in his YouTube audience and you're like, well, I guess we're not fucking worth caring about. if we're just like, if we're their backup guys, you got to go to the above our heads, go to the CEOs of Twitter and be like, hey, guys, I need help.
Yeah. How does that make you feel? Right. Think about that. Think about how bad that is, guys. That's something we guys kind of think is normal, but it's totally not. It's like, all right, you guys here, you're not doing the job. So I'm going to have to go above you guys and go to the next level. All right. So all you guys in chat right now, you guys, whatever you want to do, whatever. Hold on a second. I got a tweet while I'm on stream, by the way. Go ahead. You know,
who's the tweet for as well? Like, is he hoping that there's someone out there going, oh, I've not heard of this guy before. Like, yeah. This guy needs my help. Like, yeah, is there someone specific that he knows is on Twitter that isn't in his chat or something? I don't know. Like, which one is it? I don't know.
I don't know. It's just like ramping up the desperation to his YouTube audience. Like, they're the ones who see it.
Yeah.
I guess.
His Twitter, that's a good question for all of his Twitter, right? Is who is this for? So he just does he does a whole stream, then tweets to people that didn't see the stream, I guess, because he tells them how it went and everything. And then he does a stream about the schedule, but everyone watches the stream, they already know the schedule. So who's the schedule for? Then he has a short schedule. Who's that for? Who knows? You know, it's like,
and then he explains, who's that for?
Yeah. Original gamer, don't forget. But yeah, it's like who is all this stuff for? Right? It's like, what is any of this for?
Yeah, and then he says stuff like, you know me, you know all this already. It's like, well, what the fuck? Like, when do you assume that?
Yeah, it is a whale call. The tweets are definitely whale calls, but like, who? Imagine the whales answering that. Phil needs my help again. All right. You know, like, think about what's the thought process there? It's like, what kind of person is like, you know what, Phil asked for my help and I'm going to give it to him. I guess it's someone thinking they're being nice, I guess. Because that's what DJ Runo said, former fan of Phil, unironically, said he felt bad and he liked Phil's stuff. So he said, okay, then I give money, you know? And I guess that's what they continue to feel. I guess asking why people donate the money is a question we'll never know the answer to, really. But
right. Well, I mean, I have some ideas. Like, Only Ice Coffee just sort of single-handedly redefined what I saw a pay pick to be. Like, beforehand, I thought it was just like people working normal sort of like jobs, not really having a whole lot going for them. And they legitimately see DSP as sort of entertaining. They like the snorts. They like the gameplay stuff, I guess. They like the scat humor. But they don't really make enough money to carry this guy, no matter how many there really are. Yeah. But Only Ice Coffee is like on a whole nother level. He's like one of these guys who spends all of his disposable income on DSP. Like, he doesn't have anything else going for him. And like, congratulations, you guys, on 21 episodes. And hopefully at some point, one of these guys can grow the testes to come on stream and just sort of explain just the answer to one question. Why him? Like, it's fine. You can do whatever you want with your money. You can give your money to anyone. You can give it to charity. You can give it to like one of those hot tub streamers on Twitch, whatever. But why him? Like, why him specifically? Can any of them please answer this? But I guess they're too embarrassed by the answer.
I think they're definitely
because they see a lot of them in him, like especially Only Ice Coffee, who literally wants to be in him. But I think a lot of them sort of
bust, robust. Go
ahead. They're kind of like the same kind of people. They wish they could just sit around and play video games all day and be able to afford their own house and have a wife and a cat. But they can't do it, and so they want to support someone who's made it, quote unquote, even though it's all just basically a facade. Like, it's not really a family, even. Like, you look up the dictionary, there's a reason why every definition of family, it differentiates itself from like two people, from like a couple. Right, that's a different thing. One of the big things about having a family is having to deal with interpersonal conflict, having to mediate disagreements between two people. You can't really have that when you just have one lady and a cat. They're not going to have an argument with each other that you have to get in between of and mediate. And that's one of the huge things about having a family and being a part of the family is regulating those conflicts. So that's why it really bothers me whenever he claims to have a family. He really doesn't.
That'd be an interesting question. I want someone to ask, if we could ever get a question to Phil, would be, what's the last thing you and Kat fought about? Because I bet, right, he'd say, we never fight. Yeah. And that's how people that aren't really in a relationship handle themselves. You know, if you're just like roommates, you might, you know, I know you, some of you fight, but you might not fight if you just like, you stay away from me, I'll do my thing, that's cool. But when you're married and you have, or you have a girlfriend for a while, you definitely fight from time to time, right? I could, you know, it just happens, right? But if you're not really living with someone in a real, you know, way, then you might not, right? That's not, just like they don't have a song. Remember you heard that last week?
Oh, yeah.
They said, if
they
you
have two
are
wedding photos.
Yeah, two wedding photos. If you, and they didn't have a normal courtship. And if you have a girlfriend or a wife, you have a song. I'm not saying you play it every fucking week. It's not like, all right, honey, let's play our song again. You don't do that, but you still know it, you know?
They don't even play video games together.
Yeah. It's I don't know. And I watched that. It's something. It's something. Go ahead.
It's bizarre. Like, there was that theory that basically, like, they went to Connecticut to visit the family, and the parents were just like, they like hitched them together and were like, you guys have to get married, because they knew that DSP wasn't going to pull the trigger and it was eventually going to fall apart. So they like, we got to put a noose around this horse. like, who knows?
A lot of people say, right, it seems like it's more of a roommate relationship. Obviously, that's a guess. I'll spill the beans. I was trying to put together a short of Phil and Kat's reveal. And that video, if you haven't seen that in a while, it's from 2018. It's the most awkward thing you've ever seen in your life. You know, it's just...
Right.
It's supposed to be like Phil asking questions to Kat. He asks two questions in the whole 14 minutes, and he answers both those questions for her anyway. This not letting her talk, and has the classic arm around. It's like, dun, 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 dun.
Yeah, I made like heavily edited videos of those. This
I
really
probably watched yours,
shit
yeah.
out of
oh, my God.
I love the Halloween one where she's in the Halloween costume, and he's like, do you want to stand up and turn around and show them? And she's like, no. It's like, oh, God damn it.
Yeah, ALT's got a really good idea for this short, which is something that's it's so like it. I'm surprised no one else has done it. Let's put it that way. But we're just kind of at the fine tuning stage at the moment.
Yeah, we want it to be good. It's so a good one. But okay, let's move on to the next topic here. We got a lot of stuff to talk to again. Got the hand out of the way. Got the slowest stream of the day out of the way. Let's talk about yesterday a bit, if you don't mind, about the React. Right, that's worth talking about, I think. So the first half of the stream was reacting to Rob Gaffigan's playlist of
You mean Rob Dyke.
Rob Dyke, yeah. Yeah, Rob Dyke doxed Rob Dyke, yeah, totally doxed. Talking about the dark stuff, like crime stuff. I didn't watch much of this because Phil's React content is the worst. If it's not about Rambo and John, I'm out, you know, I just can't handle it. It's just like pause. Say the most random observation of all time. Say how it reacts. Connects to you somehow, and no one cares. Then pause again. Pause again. Wow, that's really bad. Pause again. That is really one of the worst pieces of content ever. That's a fully endure if you watch that thing. But anyone have any thoughts, Sam? Do you see any of it at all? I don't blame you.
I did. Yeah, I flicked through it. I kind of wasn't watching it. I was quite literally like, I watched a bit and then I'd flick to another bit. But there was one moment that stood out to me, which I imagine kind of sums the whole thing up, where he was talking about a guy, or Rob was talking about a guy that had, he'd lost his legs and he was thrown overboard from a ship. And then, you know, so it's just this sad story. And then all you hear from Phil is, that was it.
So I have legs. I don't know if you guys know this, but they're on my body. So
Sam, really say anything likes.
About this.
100 likes, Sam. 100 likes.
Yeah,
I know. Actually, don't think clicking like on a live stream helps at all. So it really doesn't matter if this stream gets 100 likes or two. I don't think it affects it.
Of course, but anyways, thanks so much, guys. 100 likes. You guys are totally legends. We are very grateful for your 100 likes. There it is. I hope you can see it now.
Did he say at one point that like likes don't really mean anything?
Yeah, but
that's what it says. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, he said that. He said it, we have that in the clip, actually. It says that. Cool. Like, likes don't matter. They mean nothing at all. Less than a year ago, he said that, by the way. Less than a year ago, he said, likes don't matter. They don't mean anything. Also, this year, in 2022, you see React content is the lowest form of content on YouTube, by the way.
Yep.
And all the guy suggesting it, an asshole.
Yep.
The guy that suggested in his chat, he said, you're an asshole. It's the lowest form of content on the internet. 2 months later, he's doing a React. So thanks to that fan for that great, great suggestion that he did take.
Are we going to go over the number four worst streamer on YouTube?
Yeah, that's on the list as too. Yeah, so we should cool. That. So real quick, let's finish this the marathon thing real quick. He did mention Walmart during this and basically called the poor Walmart's for poor people. Obviously,
the dregs of society. I think he said.
Yeah, the dregs of society go to Walmart, and I looked. I was trying to find that. Quote. So I looked on PicPicGo. I found one from 2017. This is what he said. Okay. He says, in 2017, Walmart is the worst place to shop. Walmart preys on those who can't afford nice stuff. And also, it preys upon the lower class. So I get that people don't like Walmart. It does take away, you know, small businesses, stuff like that, for sure. But aren't they just giving the lower class cheaper stuff? I mean, is there more to it than that? Am I thinking about this wrong? To me, it seems like they are helping people that need it, and I definitely shop there all the fucking time because I like cheap stuff. But maybe chat, you have a different idea, or someone else has a different idea. But that take is so elitist, right? That's the way to put it, is elitist. It's like, oh, I don't shop there unless I have to. I go to Costco, where I get my commodities, of course. Yeah. Paper plates, 5,000 paper plates every week.
Classy paper plates. Yeah.
Now I'm just wondering what the
sort of white.
I'm just wondering what the equivalent is in the UK for Walmart, because I just assumed it was like any other supermarket. But
I don't know. Walmart seems like a uniquely American enterprise.
It's just it's nothing special to it. It's very, they have what you need, and it's the cheapest place to buy it. Usually, where I live, it definitely is. And you can buy the same item from Walmart, or I can go to a nicer grocery store and pay more for the exact same item. So where am I going? You know, I'm not an asshole.
I mean, they have a really great delivery service. I use theirs all the time. Like, I'm like DSP. I don't want to go to the grocery store and buy groceries. I'd rather go to a website, click, 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 get everything I need and have it show up on my doorstep. But he doesn't want to do that. He wants to do DoorDash every other day, but he doesn't want to have more time to spend with his wife by getting his groceries delivered to him. I really don't get that.
I think he wants more time out of the house. That's what I think. And
it's sort of like his adulting ritual.
Yeah. That's what I think it is. Because you're right. Like, you could do, just order your groceries online, get them delivered. And for someone as busy as Phil, seems like it'd be a pretty good idea, don't you think? But no.
It's perfect for a streamer. It's like it's perfect for someone like him.
I'm a gamer. So yeah, it seems like he would do that. But no, he wants to go outside. He wants to go out in the world once a week with his little ritual. Like you said, I'm a big boy. That's what I think. But I don't know.
I think the class warfare stuff is mostly playing into sort of like his sense of like cultural Marxism, where like rich people are bad and that they need to like have more responsibility because they're rich. And if they don't, like, if they're not paragons of society, then they don't deserve to have all the money that they have. And that us, the lower class, we need to rise up and hold them to their own standards. But of course, like every Marxist leader, DSP himself is very wealthy, making over $100,000 a year. But he constantly is like, I'm you guys. I'm not one of those rich people. I'm one of you.
That's got to be.
I think he's an unaware
you.
Marxist. I think if he actually looked up what Marxism is, he was realized that he's pretty much one of those guys.
That's a good way to put it, I think. And I think that's like a gatekeeping mechanism for his chat to be a real fan of DSP. So you have to not be smart enough to realize how much money he's making more than you, and he's trying to pretend he has the same problems as you, as everyone in the world, or worse, right? He wants you to believe that his problems are bigger than everybody's. Which, I mean, everyone has problems in their life. Let's get real. But money is not, it doesn't have to be a problem for him. We know that, right? But he right. chooses to make it be a problem, right?
Wings is definitely like that. He's like, I'm one of the most trolled people on the internet. And it's like, no, dude. And like his detractors are trying to tell his supporters, like, Wings thinks his life is worse than yours, when a lot of the people who give him money have really terrible lives.
Yeah. And don't worry, guys. We will talk about the Derek comment. I'm getting a lot of comments about that comment. It's coming up.
I'm getting distracted.
All right, that's it. That was the react is usual react bullshit. Then in this one we have to talk about, the most recent one, WWE DSP fantasy commentator stream. That was, oh man. We were talking Discord about this live watching it, and it really is Phil's, where he can be Phil, I think. Like, Phil, he loves it. And his excitement goes through that fucking roof when he's doing these, because I think it gives him the most runway to do his kind of humor, right?
Oh, yeah.
And you get to see what he thinks is funny. And wow, is that not funny? You know what I mean? It's just, yeah. It's incredible.
It's like a 40-year-old man with, like, action figures, and he's just slamming them against each other and going, like, woo, woo, oh, what a hit. Wow, bang, bang, boom. It's like, geez, yeah. How old are you?
It also, not only that, but he also gets to show that he knows, like, where these characters come from. You know,
or like
he,
wrestling he, terminology, he, like the moves.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, he gets to say, you know, this is Chucky, and if you don't know who Chucky is, Chucky was in Child's Play, and it's like, yeah, okay, I get why you're doing this now.
I knew right away, like he was selling it as like a spooky Halloween themed thing, but of course I'm thinking like, oh, you're gonna have people like Wings in there, and of course he's low tier god, that Halloween icon, low tier god. You see him every Halloween.
But remember, they bring DSP up, he doesn't bring them up, right?
Yeah, and I like how like Wings is like defined by one characteristic. And one only, in that he's fat. So he's like, he's the fat guy. He's Wings. If he gets thrown out of the ring, and some other fat person goes into the ring, he's Wings all of a sudden too. Like,
yep.
Come on, man.
It's so clear, transparent with his like. He says he doesn't want to bring up other people. He was wanting drama on the stream, but he consistently does this kind of shit just for the drama, right? Okay, no reason to have Wings in there. What does Wings have to do with Halloween, guys? What do you think?
Yeah,
you think?
Or like someone told him, hey, hey DSP, Wings is going to dress like you for Halloween. And DSP is like, that's impossible. Not possible. And he doesn't elaborate on that or say why it's impossible. But you know why. Like, he's so goofy. Like, I was playing Bayonetta 2 yesterday after that whole Bayonetta rant. And and then afterwards I watched This Is How You Don't Play Bayonetta 2, and he is absolutely just hammered, just smashed off his ass drunk. Like, first of all, he's having a lot of fun with it, which is weird, seeing him like body positive about Bayonetta, being like, oh, ass and titties, woohoo, comparing it to today. But obviously he's like, he's so hammered. And that was the moment, that was the era where he's like, oh, everyone saw me as like this guy who's like, he's playing video games, he's having fun, he's making a lot of money. But in reality, I was depressed. I was a depressed alcoholic. And everyone is like, yeah, we fucking knew. Like, he didn't hide it from anyone. One of his most well-known playthroughs is his Fallout 3 playthrough. Like, that's one everyone brings up like as a like a meme. Yep. He was completely drunk during that too.
Oh, yeah.
And that was part of the appeal. It's like this drunk idiot schlub, like, bumbling his way through the game, and he acted like no one knew that he was drunk. And that's why it's a lot easier for me to believe, like, he actually thinks that people don't realize he's been playing WWE champions. He thinks he still has the wool pulled over everyone's eyes, because it's very similar to how he was an alcoholic and he thought he was fooling everyone and no one really knew.
Yeah. And what I think though is, he always says he was depressed then. I don't know if I believe that, because he had more fun then. At least he showed it. Every game was, well, I mean, he got pissed at the game and stuff sometimes, but he at least was like animated and kind of like into it.
Yeah.
Now he's not into it at all, unless the money comes in. He gets the money buff, right? Because I did a tweet yesterday about that. Well, he already had like $75 or something like this during his stream, and he still bitched, right? Bitched like, all right, guys, we can't even hit the second tier goal during a marathon. This is not good. You know, like, That so he's already depressed about that, which, again, very chill action for a streamer to do that, by the way, is to remind you how you haven't hit any goals yet. Extremely chill. I feel so chill when
very
that happens.
Relaxing.
I love when streamers do that when I'm in their chat. I get so chill instantly. I just like fall back in my chair like, oh shit, I'm so chill right now.
It's just like a business, right? You go to a restaurant and the waiter is like, hey, I haven't gotten a tip in like a few hours. What the fuck, dude? And you're like, what the
chills
hell?
Me, that chills me right
what kind
now.
Of restaurant is this?
But anyway, so then he gets that whale march kind of whatever. Oh, and he also said, By the way, someone said in chat, I'll match any $50 donation
that
he gets. If it happens during this video, 10 minutes left in the video, what does Phil do? All right, guys, just want to remind you that someone said they would match it. So if you want a tip, don't wait. Do it now.
Are you kidding me?
Oh, he did that, Sam. He did it.
So easy to troll. Like, I think it's so funny how he's complaining about how he can't stop anything he's doing to answer a phone call from Keemstar. But you know how to make him stop everything he's doing? You go into his chat and you say, hey, Phil, I tried to tip you and it didn't work. He'll stop everything he's doing. The game stops. Everything stops. And he tries to unclog that wallet-to-mouth pipeline immediately. It's, yep, it's so funny.
That's what we should have told Keemstar.
But it's not about the money, you guys. It's about the games.
We should have told Keemstar to say, I donated in your chat. He'd be like, oh, hold on. And then I love this manual tipping thing. It's so funny because you just go through the whole ritual.
Everyone is so-and-so now.
Turn
and
into the
so
right.
Surreal. It's so surreal knowing that I'm the one responsible for that. It's so wild.
It's so good.
I mean, everything has like ups and downs. Like the bad thing is that you can't see the notifications pop up on screen. So it's a lot harder to tell like what the actual tip amount is. He could just be making it all up at this point.
Yeah, yeah, you know.
But I still think it's very funny that he has to lean in and manually play every single animation.
Yeah.
From now on, because I reported in the stream elements.
Turn it to the left. Turn to the right. Go ahead, Sam.
Oh, I was
so
just going to say
dead air, but
yeah, it's like with, and it's almost kind of like another similar situation to when he lost his Twitch partnership. It's not quite that bad, obviously, because he can still get super chats and whatever. But it just goes to show the kind of levels he's willing to kind of stoop to continue what he's doing. You know, with the Twitch thing, he was like, "Oh, I'll keep doing this," but everything's kind of tip focused now. And it's not too far removed from that, where it's like he's trying to keep it going, but he's having to put a little bit more work into it, sort of thing. Now it's just like, yeah,
and it blows holes right into his whole argument that, oh, if we get him banned off every platform, we're gonna cut off the gravy and we won't get any more gravy. It's like, dude, I know of lolcows who are literally homeless and they stream from their phones. They're just as smug as you are, DSP. They keep putting out content even if they don't have anything else. So you know what? You losing your house, that's a sacrifice I'm willing to make, because I think the content is going to keep on continuing, believe it or not.
Yeah,
well, it'd probably be legitimately more interesting to watch, wouldn't it? Like, you know, a little bit of IRL streaming, you know.
Can you imagine? Yeah,
something like, different at least.
Like the house hunt again? house hunt drama?
We get the next Connecticut house tour. We finally get to see that Connecticut house again.
That'd be cool. I mean, it'd be a little change of pace at least, you know, for this current stretch we're on. We're just like, it's just a sad place to be. Everything is sad, you know?
It just reminded me that DSP said that his parents were stuck in the rut. They're stuck in a rut.
Not him. Nope. I'm still winning. I'm winning here on level one. I'm happy to be here on level one. Asking all you for all your money. I love that. When I was like, he's so proud of me on level one, but that, think about what he's saying there. I'm happy begging for you, for your guys' money every single day, right?
Well, it's and also that, like complimentary, because he's not at level one.
I know.
He's below that.
Yeah.
So it's sort of like him trying to dictate how you're allowed to make fun of him. Like, oh, you're allowed to make fun of like me being bad at Street Fighter 6. Yeah, sure, whatever. But don't say like I only was relevant on the PS1 version of Super Turbo. That's a myth. That was debunked.
Yeah. So that one part he holds on to. Like, yeah, that was nothing. Yeah. But I was looking at seeing when this like tip focused thing happened. It's been years now, by the way, that it's been this tip focused lifestyle he has now, where like I'm focusing on tip. If you have the option, tipping is preferred.
We just got to get through this rough patch, man.
Yeah, yeah. How many rough patches shall there be? Someone should do the that kind of counter on a disc that you don't play. Rough patch counter. Because it's
That's
in the hundreds.
That's a good one, yeah.
Rough patch counter. This guy's a rough patch farm right now, because he has so many rough patches, and it's always that next one, right? Boogie just pulled the same
light
shit last
at the
week.
End of the tunnel.
Yeah, you know, you saw Boogie's big video last week or whatever. I don't know if you saw it, but same thing. If we can just get past this winter season, if we can get past these two big bills, if we're
gonna
get
have to work again,
game,
you guys, like people are gonna be like, oh no, fuck, Boogie, stop, don't.
I might have to go to Royal Drive, guys. Oh my god, Boogie, please. Okay, here's save for 75.
Don't
bucks.
Say that.
And also, yeah, I should have mentioned it. During his bank stream, Phil literally said these words. The reason I'm streaming tonight is to raise tips. Can anyone out there tell me how that is different than any other fucking stream he has ever done.
Or he's like, I got enough money to pay my upcoming bills this week, and now I just need money for my day off. It's like, what? What? All the money I'm making now is going towards my day off because all the bills are paid. And it's like, what the fuck?
All right, so the bills are taken care of then. Whoa, let's not get hasty. You know, that's what he said.
I got a day off coming up? Like, it's some impending crisis. Like, it's not like something he set up for himself.
Yeah, the day off is a negative kind of. It's a detractor, basically. I have to support the day off, guys. It's another family. It's another member of my family, basically. I have to support it. All right. One thing we should talk about before we get to that Derek comment. Everyone's talking about Derek comment. We'll get there. We're going to edge you guys a little bit. Stink bug.
Oh.
Huge problem, guys. If you've ever seen these stink bugs, they are monstrous. It takes you a week to take care of one. And Phil said, okay. Phil, of course, goes to his stream because it's content, right? This is podcast content. He drags it out. Hey, guys, how do you recommend I take care of a stink bug? And I don't know, Sam, you have those over there, I'm sure, too, right? Stink bugs.
I was literally just looking into it because I didn't actually see this happen, and I wanted to know like what they are, because all I've seen is the like someone put a picture of one in like a Tupperware thingy.
Yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah, he
was,
did put it in Tupperware. Yeah.
I don't know if we get them over here.
Camera.
He was super worried about the smell. So it is a myth that people do think is true. It's not true though. If you kill it, the smell will get more. Will bring more in. That's not true though. Old I know people still. Say that. Yeah. What do I have stale thing?
And you dilute it with cherry juice.
So he was worried about like this whole, and he also said this, there's a tiny hole in my screen and a lot of bugs come through there.
Oh, what the fuck?
Yeah. So like what you might want to take care of that. I mean, it might be something you like look into, right?
Or just not have bugs. Like just stick the ants on them, Phil. They'll be fine.
If you have a reason that bugs are coming in and you know that, you might want to stop that reason, right? But he didn't talk about that. He's like, I have this tiny hole in my screen. The bugs just come in. It's a mess. You know, it's like, okay.
Well, it's not the first time either.
You can fix this kind of stuff in your house. You know that, right? Or somebody to tell you that. No one told you, so you don't know, I guess. I don't know.
Maybe they just want the heat. Maybe they just like the heat. It's cooler outside. They want to go inside and get warm.
They want to burn up, yeah, because it's so hot in there. They love melting to death like Phil is. Anyway, so
hey,
yeah.
Phil, a stink bug.
And someone said, like, you can put it in a Tupperware. And Phil was, like, amazed at this idea, by the way. He was like, whoa, yeah. Great idea.
Like, you realize, like, some people are eating while they're doing this, right? Like, they don't want to see, like, you dangling bugs in front of the camera.
Great idea. This dude has a mind-breaking idea of getting a Tupperware and putting the bug in there. Like, it's some, like, mind-blowing thing. But anyways. And also, oh yeah, one last thing, a small point. No one's pointing out yet. He added the Tupperware. He says, okay, I'm gonna go throw it outside. I'm gonna be nice. He didn't do anything wrong. Okay, whatever, that's cool. Goes to take it out. There was a squirrel on the back porch. So he says, I didn't want to scare the squirrel, so I went to the front door. I was thinking, like, that's not nothing wrong with that, but it's like just a weird thing to do. Like, don't you just, if I see a squirrel, I just open the door and the squirrel runs away. Yeah. Like, it's not a
I'm no,
not,
you're gonna traumatize the squirrel.
I don't know. It's one of those things that Phil says I don't understand the thought process behind him. Like,
also, I thought it was funny. Like, oh, I'm not going to kill him. He didn't do anything wrong. And it's like, what about all the other bugs?
Yeah, you kill the fuck out of those ants.
Or the other stink bugs. Like, this wasn't the first time. Like, there's bugs all in this dude's house. It's so gross.
Yeah. So he really said that. Like, there was a squirrel on my back porch. So I didn't want to scare it. So I went to my front door. It's like, oh, okay. I guess that's something a human might think, I guess. I don't know. I don't know. We could traumatize a squirrel by maybe he's scared of a squirrel.
Attack Jasper. They'll go after Jasper as revenge.
Just kill a cat. Yeah. A squirrel might kill a cat, I guess. The bugs are detractors. So good point, Jack. Go ahead.
I mean, the squirrel thing's weird in that it's a weird thing to think, but also a weird thing to, like, why even bring it up? You know, that is like one of those things where it's like, this guy has nothing to talk about.
Right. Oh, he doesn't talk to anyone, too. Like, he has no friends. He doesn't talk about this with Kat. She's like basically nonverbal, I guess. And there's only one people to talk to, and that's a dude at the chat. Hey, dude.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's definitely the people. That's what burns Phil the most, because he hates his chat. Let's get real. He hates fucking chat. He does, too. That's why the podcast. Let's bring it full circle. Why he got the podcast here is because he makes him play the game less. And that's really always after. It's to not play those fucking games for those people anymore, because he does not want to be doing that. He has no fun. He chooses games he hates, like, or doesn't have to think during, like Dreamlight Valley, which is, man, those streams, those games. I like the fishing. I'm a fishing fan. I like Phil fishing. because it's just funny. Because he tries to pretend he's in that world. He knows it. It's fun. But Disney Dreamlight is who
it's
is
creepy.
Watching?
Like his avatar that he picks in the game, it just gives you the creeps.
Yeah. It's very creepy.
It's like, it's just this big 40-year-old man with his giant gut walking around Disneyland, just talking to cartoons. And you're like, what? Where am I?
Yeah, that's what makes me think, too. It's like, what is this? What universe are we in where this is like, and people donate money to this person? And I really don't know what his thinking is there.
And if you suggest like Cult of the Lamb, he's like, oh, that's an Animal Crossing knockoff. And it's like, well, what the fuck are you playing here?
Yeah, this is Animal Crossing, like, not interesting mode is what Disney Dreamlight is. You know, and it's like, man. All right. But anyways, let's move on. Just getting too much in the weeds here. But Derek tweet time, I think. Anyone else have any comment? Scorn? Want to mention that? Any thoughts on Scorn from Ludwig here?
Yeah. I got up at like 5 a.m. and started playing that the other day when it released. A lot of fun. DSP, for some reason, thought that the gaming community was divided on the idea of Scorn being an action game, like a Doom game, when literally every single trailer leading up to it let you know that it's like a very slow, methodical puzzle sort of game. But he made up this like divide in the gaming community. Looks really good, amazing on PC, kind of short, I guess, but other than it's Game Pass, so really who cares? It's not like you blew like $30 on it and it's like, oh man, a 4-hour long game.
Yep, fuck no. And also, want to mention, he got wailed out in the pre-stream during that game. So I was really interested, like, if this game sucks, I want to see how he handles the post-stream tweet, because, you know, whenever he gets over 150 hours, it's great no matter what. He says, oh, this game was great. I loved it. It always makes the game awesome. So I was really hoping he didn't like the game. He kind of seemed like he had a middle reaction there in his tweet afterwards. Like, I'm not sure yet. Gave it the kind of, we'll see if this continues, you know, feeling. But is the game good, though? I mean, do you enjoy it? Or,
I mean, it's my kind of game, but it's definitely not Phil's kind
of
game.
A lot of talk about him using guides. How difficult, though, is it? That's a question I want to ask.
How difficult?
Because a lot of people think he used guides because all his guesses of how to do stuff was right. So it seems like he might be using a guide, but I don't know enough to say that.
Probably just being handheld by chat and he's just not making note of it.
Yeah.
Because after that Bayonetta 2 rant, I went ahead and played Bayonetta 2 yesterday. It was a lot of fun. Like his weird rant about how like it's the craziest story you'd ever hear that a voice actress would be offered $4,000 to voice act for a game. And that's pretty much average, but no, she's Bayonetta. Like, let's forget about all the other foreign voice actresses who voices this character. No, this one American voice actress, she and she alone is Bayonetta.
He gets latches onto, right?
Yeah, anything where he can like look at people who aren't getting paid enough money and being like, oh my god, Nintendo has so much money, they should have offered her more money because they have all their money. And it's like, it's so obvious how you went bankrupt. And like how you just blew everything, because have no concept of like how these businesses are supposed to operate.
Okay, thanks, guys. So he did admit to using a guide. Okay, so that there you go.
Oh, great.
Oh my god. So he's like, think of the levels of handholding he has now. Back in the day,
this is how don't plays aren't really worth making.
That's why
anymore.
It's really hard to make a good one now, because back in the day he had the controller, the TV, and that's it. And we get to see the fun of him trying to figure shit out. Now he has chat helping him. Now he's using guides too. Like, where is the fun aspect of being a real gamer now? It's not there anymore.
Yeah, because I think the last one.
Go ahead, Sam.
Just because he's on such an autopilot as well, he's obviously struggling to form opinions about the game because I guess he's not taking anything in. I could just imagine he's kind of laser focused on like doing the thing he knows that he's got to do, that he's not actually taking in the environment, which is why when you get to his end of the year awards or whatever you want to call them, it's literally the same three things. It's like, you know, all the graphics were good, it was interesting and fun and different, you know, and he's got nothing constructive to say about anything.
Just saying in chat, he's always used guides. I disagree, though, because there were some times where he was legitimately stuck, had no idea what he's doing, and he's fucking lost. That was magic, right? That's why this how you don't play is so good, Ludwig, don't you think? I think there's some games he doesn't use.
I think the last time that was the Resident Evil 3 remake with that one boss where he's literally just putting the controller down and his arms are crossed and he's like, I'm not going to do anything until people tell me what to do. Like, that was the last real, like, this is how you don't play style moment. But even like Elden Ring was basically ruined because he was handheld through the entire thing. Like right before the Radahn fight, as he's taking the elevator down to the fight, people in chat are like telling him, oh, there's summoning portals, like use those immediately right away. And he's like, oh, I'm like, all right, well, we don't even get like a fucking organic experience with this game anymore. So like, what the fuck is the point?
Yeah.
And I'm just waiting for the end of the year list so I can compare the comments that he says about Elden Ring to the actual things that he said while playing it, which is always fun. The DSP versus DSP videos are some of my favorite because it's just back-to-back contradictions because it's like Mr. Sam was saying, whenever he's playing a game, I mean, he's not a gamer, he's a beggar, and the video games are just something he does in between the begging. Yeah. So he doesn't really pay attention to the games at all. He doesn't remember anything about the plot or the atmosphere or really what's going on.
Yeah, yeah.
He endures the game while it lasts. He hates every second of it. And when the game is over and can no longer hurt him, then he's like, oh man, what a great experience, which is is so like the opposite of what you see. Like there's this phenomenon. Yeah. If you interview people who walk outside of a movie theater and you ask them about the movie that they just watched, they're like 95% just overwhelmingly positive. It's not until they get home and they think back on the experience that they realize, oh, maybe that movie wasn't really as good as I thought it was.
Yeah.
Because they're in that moment in that like outdoors experience. So it's like feeling very positive to them. That's why you see like a lot of movie like advertisers interview people as they walk out of the theater because they're all so positive.
Yeah.
Whereas with DSP, he looks back in it and he's positive about it in hindsight because he hated the experience as it was going on.
Yes, yeah, that's one of the classic DSP moves is like, fuck the developers, they're pieces of shit, I want them to die, I want to go to their house and kill them. Then they go to the wrap-up, like, all right, well, 9 out of 10, I liked it.
And people pointed this out, and he's like, well, I'm in the heat of the moment. And it's like, what? No, that's when you're at your most honest.
Yeah, yeah.
The most recent example being Street Fighter VI is a classic already. Like, you know, he was nothing, well, I won't say nothing but negative, but... You know, anytime I ever saw him playing, it was just moaning, complaining. And then, you know, we saw what happened on Twitter and everything.
Yeah, like Drive Impact is the worst mechanic of all time, should not exist. It is catch, whatever, all that shit. And then after he's like, well, they got to have a catch up mechanic. And, you know, then he kind of just thought about it, what he was saying, and says, like, oh, everyone else is kind of liking this. So I can't have that thought anymore. So he kind of changed his thing. Yeah. And some people are saying, like, okay, I know he did use guys intermittently, but there wasn't like, I don't think, like, some of those, like, GTA games, there's no way he used the guide for all of it. I know there's sometimes where it's like, all right, there's a puzzle we can't get. Like, the famous one is a safe. The safe one where you had to do the numbers, and he can't figure it out. It's like there's four numbers or whatever, and if you kick whatever, you could choose 1 to 10. And if you choose a number correct, it'll be a certain color. And if you choose it correct, but it's in the wrong location, it'll be a different color. He couldn't figure that out at all. He had no idea the concept. And then after a break, he puts in a number like, whoa, I can't believe I just did it. I just got it. That's a classic.
It's like the Guardian Ape 2. He was like failing and then goes on break and comes back. And his gameplay is completely different from before he went on break.
Yep, yep. And then, of course, he pretends like no one can figure that out at all. But all right, we better get to, the Derek comment now, because we need to talk about that. So I'll read the Derek comment before and then we can all get our comments out. Sam, you get to answer first. I don't think you know what you're talking about here. This is Derek's comment to at DSP Gaming, of course. Do you think the guy kidnapping the child should go to jail or get a warning?
Hey, stop that.
Kidnapping the child. I don't want to take anything out of context here. I want to say everything. This is Derek. He has a crown. It's at DSP Gaming. He says, do you think the guy kidnapping the child should go to jail or get a warning? Go ahead,
Sam.
Stop
kidnapping those kids. You've been warned.
Go ahead, Sam.
I wish I had more to say, but I'm not even sure what they were talking about at the time. Like, I mean, obviously kidnapping a kid is never a good thing, and you should probably go to jail for doing that at the very least.
Fire up the slave trade, sell off the profit.
Fire up the slave trade. Oh, God.
Hateful slurs.
Hateful never, slurs. Ever. You haven't told me. You ghosted me. What is that?
But yeah, that's it's like Blip literally sent him links and he just used it to argue with him. So if Twitch ever sent him links to videos, he was just arguing against those as well. He just wants something to argue against.
Harry Otter Gaming.
I love the Stream Elements response too, just being like, don't email us back.
Yeah, don't.
And it's this, people like him that they have to be like that too, because he would love to just argue with them.
Yep.
But they're just like, no, we're not in the mood to argue. You're out.
You don't
here.
Answer this email. Don't try it, bitch. Harry Potter Gaming has a joke of the day so far. Derek listens to Amber Alert daily.
Oh god.
Oh my god. That's bad. That's bad.
Like,
but yeah,
storm
that's,
chasers.
Yeah, it's really, really bad. Obviously, that shows where the mindset is, though, right? Like, to think about a warning in that situation shows something is very wrong, right? Very, yeah. very wrong. That's all I
like
can say.
Like, on one hand, you have to be happy. Like, at least he's in DSP's chat and not, like, roaming around.
Maybe that's what the parents are paying for those Disney Dreamlight streams, you know what I'm saying? Lord. Keep him in the house for a while. But, okay. Anyways, let's move on to questions. So, Sam, you're going to be in charge of asking the questions to our boy, Ludwig, here. He's been an excellent guest so far. And, Ludwig, just so we can get people hyped here, are you going to be streaming after this?
Yes, I'll be doing a post discussion if anyone wants.
Cool. We'll get
Ludwig World Order on Twitch and YouTube members only. My members only is $1 a month. DSP could lower his price if he wanted to, but he doesn't want to.
He does not. But okay, go ahead, Sam. Can you read the questions, please, sir?
Yeah, sure thing. What was it like working with Liquid Richard on the absolute banger Blame It on Detractors, which you heard before the stream, by the way?
Yeah, it is on the album. And also Look It Like I Listen is on another album of his. But we didn't really work together at all. Yeah, he's a busy dude. He was doing all of his own tracks. And I basically just made my own thing and I sent it to him. He didn't like how it sounded. He sent it back and I made it sound a little bit better and he liked it. And that's about it. It just ended up on the album. I wish I could have learned more about how to make music from him, but he just up and disappeared.
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough. Mm-hmm. Fair enough. Can you make a VTuber model snort? Oh, can you make a VTuber model snort? Question mark.
Got you. Snort? So yeah. Like the nose flare up. I guess so.
Yeah, because obviously you can't audio wise, but I guess visually that's the problem.
On Twitch, you have like channel points, and I have a thing where people can redeem like 50,000 channel points in order to request a custom costume. So again, I have like 90 costumes total. It's a lot of fun.
Oh, cool. Okay, go ahead, Sam.
Thoughts on the teeth style situation when Dave eats.
It's so bizarre when he eats. Like his eating is really bothering me because apparently, like allegedly, his dad is a Marine, and I can't imagine that. Like, I mean, there is no former Marines, right? You know.
Yeah. Yep.
So it really blows me away how he has just such bad table manners. Like my dad was Air Force, which isn't nearly as hardcore as Marines, and he would get pissed at like if I ate with my mouth open. And I stopped, you know, it's good. It's tough love. And I see his videos and it's just like, this guy was raised by a Marine. It just blows me away. I don't imagine it. Well, and like he tilts his eyes back in his head like a shark. It's so weird.
Yeah. He definitely looks like it's in pain though. I definitely agree with that. Like, it just, when he takes the bite is when the pain happens too. It's like, oh, you know, it's like really
like he's
something.
An animal. Like he's trying to like kill it. And die.
So didn't give bizarre. Me any utensils. Yeah, it's really weird. But anyways, yeah, go ahead.
Very and the important. Way he holds the fork, like sometimes the fork is upside down. It's like, what are you doing?
Uses a spoon with a cup noodles. Classic. Go ahead, Sam.
Amazing. Are you ever planning on stopping making new ones? Not sure I understand.
That new videos.
Maybe that's a follow on from.
No. No plans. I'm working on a really long video right now. I uploaded an actual preview. People really love the preview, but I don't think they realize that there's a lot more going into it, especially with the new news with the Stream Elements stuff. And I have clips from other people just believing what DSP says about like mass false flag reports, which again is all bullshit. People bringing actual things that he does recently to their attention and they take action. There's no mass false flagging going on. And then for the end of the year, when he does his end of the year countdown and talks about Elden Ring again, that's going to be a big Elden Ring video. So that's what I have planned coming up. And next year is probably going to be more animation oriented. I know you guys were lamenting that there weren't a whole lot of new animations around lately. And I feel like trying to give that a shot. Implementing a lot of like AI assistant stuff. I don't know if you guys saw the music video, the AI generated video, but that stuff is like really fascinating. And like I wish Steve of the Dead was here so we could talk about like sort of the future of like psychology of this stuff. But anyways, go on.
Yeah. Okay. Next question, Sam.
Yeah, we didn't even touch on Jamie Bulger or anything like that.
Yeah, we did. Yeah. Well, man.
Oh, the fourth worst YouTuber.
And that as well, yeah.
That as well, yeah. But there's something, yeah, because I didn't get that. It was a kind of a British thing, right, Sam? Could you hit on that?
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously, Steve went nuts on Twitter about it, and you know, I assumed, because I think we're similar ages, me and Steve. So he obviously had more knowledge about it at the time than I did, because I remember it being big news, but I was a kid. I just remember seeing the picture of the two kids that did it, you know, that carried out the crime, and it was just the biggest thing, you know, in the news at the time. It caused sort of certainly Europe wide and probably worldwide, you know, debate and controversy about whether, you know, adolescent or not even adolescents, 10-year-olds should be tried in an adult trial. Yes,
yeah, so real quick, so that people know, they 10-year-olds killed a person, right?
Yeah, killed a 2-year-old. Kid.
Wow.
Yeah, like kidnapped and brutally killed a 2-year-old. And were tried as adults, I believe.
10 years old. Yeah.
Yeah.
So what was Phil's comment to that, though?
The big one was because he didn't hang around very long with it. He just moved on quite quickly, think. But the big thing was, you know, it was like, where are the parents? You know, that was the big thing. It's just like, man. Yeah. But I think we'll have to go back to this.
We'll bring it up again with Steve here.
Probably if, you know, if Steve's around for the call-in show or something, I think we need to get Steve's opinion on this. I'm assuming we'll probably get a 7-hour video out of this, but probably, you know, that's in a few months time, you know, once he's done everything else. But it was we'll leave that for Steve to talk more about, I think.
Yeah, so also the real bad fourth place thing, real quick, before we get to the last question, the fourth place video thing. I thought like the first place person should definitely not be the most hated. I don't know, what are your thoughts on the ranking there, Ludwig?
I didn't hear about a lot of them. I heard about Wings. I heard about DSP. A lot of them, I don't really know a whole lot.
Sky Does Minecraft was number one, which I thought was weird. I know he had some kind of, I don't think he's like a hated dude. I mean, I know it feels like he did one bad thing and yes, people don't like him, but it's like, all right, people have moved on, but people have not moved on from DSP at all. You know what I mean? I don't know. I thought it was funny
how they said the game that he played was WWE Legends when they could read WWE Champions on the screen.
It's almost, you know, when you see these videos from people outside of the Tractor Sphere or whatever, they always seem to, without fail, drop the ball in some way. And that was the big one there. I mean, for a start, he probably should have been number one on the list. But yeah, secondly, saying that, you know, come on, you just got to get that one fact.
It almost
seems
like bait. Like, it's baiting people to
tell them. Yeah, it could be on purpose, right? That could be a strategy in social media to say, get a little bit wrong so you get 1,000 comments, right? I mean, it's a strategy.
I think people do actually. Yeah, you're right. People do that.
I mean, Trump did that. He would intentionally put like typos into his tweets just to get the media to talk about him.
All right, go ahead, Sam.
which is your favorite VTuber costume?
Favorite one? Oh man, I'm really growing on the clown one. I don't know if you know the clown Giru from Phoenix Wright, but I made one a variation for Anleet, and his chat really loved the clown.
Oh, cool.
Whenever DSP is in clown mode, it's just a perfect complimentary costume. We're just all clowns.
Cool. All right, I like this. I'll get this one, Sam. Wildest theory that you believe is true about Phil? Like, what's the one that, you know, kind of out there, one that you think is actually true?
Oh.
Like, example would be escort. Example would be, where do you stand on in the tissue, not at all? Oh. Or what's your statement on that? A lot of people have been asking behind the scenes about this. I really need to get this on the record from me.
Jesus. It just went on the couch.
Okay.
It went on the couch, and then Kat sat on it. Like,
okay. Team bust then.
You know what really blows me away about that whole Quarter Pounder interview is that DSP sells himself as like this underdog and everything. But the entire crux of Quartering's questioning during that interview was like, whose dick did you suck to get so much preferential treatment at YouTube? Like, it was the opposite of the thing he tries to get across, which is that he's this poor, depressed underdog. But really, he gets away with breaking terms of service on a regular basis.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yep. All right, but yeah, what's the way? Do you have a what's your answer for that question? Though? Do we need to get that as well?
A crazy DSP. God, I had. Maybe there's two mobile games. There's another one that we don't know about. There's WWE Champions and another one that he's sinking a huge amount of money into it. But I guess one of the ones I've already said is that Kat is suffering from a mouth infection, and that's probably what the appointments are all about, which is so horrifying. Like, he sends this woman out to go work to bring in less money than he blows on mobile games, and he can't even get her like proper medical attention. Not that I feel sorry for her, but you know, she got herself into her situation. But he's not a family man. Like, when DSP ever says like he cares about his family, like, his sister-in-law lives in a broken down van outside of a Sherwin-Williams. He doesn't give a fuck about his family.
Oh yeah. No. Just real quick, for my knowledge, where did this not know? I know we knew about Kat going to the appointments, but where did we get any more information? This is just all conjecture or what?
Oh, what, the teeth?
Yeah.
I think he has talked about like her teeth problems in the past.
Oh, okay. I just didn't hear that. Okay. So there is some basis to it from Phil himself. Okay.
Right. Next question. If you look at her mouth, she definitely has some structural issues.
We'll leave that there.
Yeah, a couple more. What was the stream/action that killed Phil for Ludwig? Killed in the...
And this is from DJ Runo. So you know what he's talking about here is what the switch from I like DSP to I want to make stuff not exactly
I never liked DSP. Again, like I came into this like after being like a Spoonie fan. So like I come from like the Spoonie side of things. Spoonie is like DSP, like the manga version of DSP. It's a few years ahead in the timeline, and it's a bit darker.
Yeah,
DSP is like the anime, whereas Spoonie is like the manga. He's already like living in it back in his parents' house. A month ago, he walked out of a doctor's appointment and found that his car was repossessed. So that's the new Spoonie lore. Like, he's really going downhill. But like, yeah, I've never really been a fan of DSP. I think it was always bad. There was no switch. No. Sorry, DJ Runo. Speaking of DJ Runo, like, I'm glad that DJ Runo is here. I have this like this policy that if you're a DSP fan, you need to be out like not a DSP fan for at least as much time as you've been a DSP fan, and then afterwards we can like welcome you with open arms, because I'm afraid of like a lot of these people like switching sides as like a gimmick or like a troll, and I don't really trust them at all. But DJ Runo is good people, you know.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. Definitely. DJ Runo is always a good person to talk to. He's always interesting and he's very open to share his thoughts.
If anyone knows
side.
About like this guy Gorilla Pimp from DSP's chat, he did that thing where he's like he gets kicked out of DSP's chat, and then he shows up in like the Tractor Discords and he's like, "Hey, dude, I'm like, whoa, I'm not crazy," and it's like, "Get out of here."
We've had a few of those in our Discord that pop up from time to time.
Discord.
But...
Yeah.
All right, Sam, last one.
Last one. And it wasn't Kaiser this week. This is from Bill Brasky. Ludwig, what's for dinner?
What's for dinner? Probably potato skins.
There we go.
Cheesy, bacony potato skins. And the toaster oven, which is apparently too complicated for DSP to figure out.
Can't use one of those. Do you use paper plates or no?
Yes, I save money by paper plates.
Oh, good. That's a great move. Great financial sense. Also, buying
and my
raw
dishwasher is working.
Yeah. Whoa, big spend. We got a baller alert. Also, he bought raw shrimp this week. Remember, Phil said that. I was on Poe's Mystery, who said he had no money for this day off. Finally, scraped by raw shrimp.
Okay, you know, enjoy the cholesterol.
I'm saying, like, is that a thing you buy when you're really penny pinching, as he likes to call it? I mean, I don't know. Anyways, what a show.
Oh, no, he needs filters for his cat's water fountain. Like, that? Like, he needs filters for his cat's water fountain. And I'm looking over, like, I got like a Tupperware container with water in it. Apparently, that's like lowbrow. Not high level like Phil is.
Oh, no, can't have that. He's filtered. Part of his family. Family members get filtered water at the Phil household. So that will do it for this one. What a show it's been. Again, I will put in Ludwig's Twitch here because he's going to stream after we're done here. Thanks so much, everybody, for your super chats and have people become members. You are all legends for sure. And Ludwig, you already talked a little bit about what's going on with you. I guess anything else you want to pimp out here when you have the chance?
Sure. My cat had kittens recently, and I've been uploading videos of it to my Patreon. So if you want to become a Patreon member, you can get videos of Gus and Crumb, the two little newborn kittens that I have. I'm on Twitch. I stream a video.
Oh, just me then. Sorry, guys. I've absolutely no idea what happened there, but I guess that's that. Or my internet went down. Anyway, thanks, everyone. Oh, they're coming back. You there, guys? Hello? No. There they are.
Help.
There we go.
Help.
No idea what happened.
Am I back?
Are you back? Can you hear Sam or not?
Mr. Sam. Stop touching my plugs.
Go ahead. Restart the plug.
I'm on Twitch. I'm on YouTube. You can see cat videos on my Patreon. And all of my paid contributors get credits at the end of like my big videos. I give them like shout outs, which DSP really should do. He should give some recognition to the people who give him money on like at least one of his videos. Or maybe like at the pre-stream, at the end of the pre-stream, just reads out like his Patreons or something stupid.
Yeah, because his fans would actually like that. Like, you know, that would be a big deal for a lot of them, I'm sure.
No, they're all so-and-so, I guess.
Yeah, so-and-so is fine. But all right, guys, thanks so much for watching. And we will definitely get back with you this week. Call-in show this week. And next week, hopefully we find a guest that can live up to what Ludwig has just dropped on us all today. That was an epic show.
Well,
thanks
feel
so
free
much for that.
To anytime.
All right, we'll definitely ask you again. We heard it here. Sam, can you please send us out?
I can indeed, yeah. I'll see you all whenever his day off is for the call-in show. And looking forward to it. See you, everyone. Thank you, everyone, for the super chats and the new members as well. You guys are awesome. See you later.
See you, guys.
Beautiful.
Shout out to Ludwig the Detractor.
Thank you very much.
That's a cool way to start, I guess, with Ludwig the Detractor.
This last year, I'll say it again, I actually do play some mobile games. I do. All right? The ones that I play are free to play or incredibly inexpensive, like you spend a dollar here or there to make progress.
This one's for all my baby girls.
Got me that gotcha.
I love it.
Got me that gotcha. 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 Begging for fucking tips and shit on Street Fighter. It's WWE Champions
time.
I'm stupid. WWE game plays like Candy Crush. Moving gems around, breaking colored gems.
I love it.
Again, it's pay to win. The more money you sink into it,